Welcome to another edition of Banter and Babble. I am the Dude 79, and joining me always, my esteemed colleague, Mr. Fanboy Tone. Mr. Fanboy Tone, fist bump. What's going on, dude?
Not a lot.
Not a whole lot.
No, it's middle of the week, which means tomorrow starts that coast into the weekend.
Into a long weekend.
Into a long weekend at that.
A long weekend of boozing and fireworks. Just always a great combination. Anytime you get booze and explosives together, what can go wrong?
Nothing.
Nothing. Everyone has a good time because Murica. Do you know what I forgot to get? You know what I forgot to get for the stream for tonight's show? I forgot to grab that Bill Pullman. Did you watch that video?
Yeah, that was pretty
the presidential
sweet.
Speech for Budweiser. Yeah.
Still one of the best president speeches
absolutely
ever.
Absolutely incredible. Oh, look at Seven Dungeons. My weekend starts now. Actually, you know what's funny is my wife, she started her weekend today, too. She took tomorrow and Thursday off, tomorrow and Friday off.
Pieces of shit.
Everyone here is a piece of shit, except for Tone.
You had a whole week off last week. Fuck off.
I did have a whole week off. Didn't seem like it, though. You know what? I made the mistake. Okay, so last weekend, my wife went out of town to Florida to go see a friend. She went from Thursday, Friday, Saturday, all through Sunday, which again leaves me home alone with the kids, aka Satan kids. And so I started off my week, the vacation of peace and quiet, and then went into like the last 4 days of just pure hell. Next time she goes out of town, I'm going to plan the vacation after the week.
Yeah, the wind down.
After she gets home. Not so I end on a low note of just getting run into the ground by those two little monsters. But that way I can have the vacation after she gets back. So, you know, I'm just figuring this shit out now, you guys. I never really have, like, a June vacation, so it was pretty nice. Like I said, normally I'm a February, October vacation guy due to seniority.
You're whatever happens in the middle of the week, just, take a day off bullshit.
Well, I mean, that's January and February. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It burns for my vacation time.
January
and then
December, don't lie.
Just a fucking disaster when it comes to that. Cheers, yeah. Jay Hill. Cheers to you, sir. And you know what? Before we get into everything else that's going on, let's talk about what we're drinking. Yeah, Everyone seems to be excited about the Bean Flicker S'mores.
Oddside Brewery, 4.something. What was it?
4.5.
4.5 Coffee Blonde Ale. It is it's a roasty marshmallowy.
You get that smoky, you've been like, you've held that marshmallow over the fire for a while. Oh, Sudden Gen says Bean Flicker Caramel is amazeballs. Ooh.
Oh, this is so good.
This is really playful. This is really playful. I'm glad it's 4.5 because if I got like a 12 pack of these, I would just smash them.
Mm-hmm.
And if it was like a 6 point something, I'd be done. This is one of those beers where if it was really strong, it would be a dangerous beer.
I like a good blonde.
Well, I mean, 4.5 is strong for you, so I mean, he might not even make it through the end of the show.
Ever. Half-assed. By the way, I do want to recognize that quote. I definitely know that's from the original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie, for the record, so I did see that.
What did he say?
Wise man once said, "Forgiveness is divine, but never pay full price for late pizza." Did catch that, so.
That's a fine reference. But yeah, we're drinking this tonight. It's actually very, very tasty. Like you said, when it hits down, you get that smoky like marshmallow flavor. It's very tasty, very playful.
You know that
so
Graham vanilla after.
Yeah, man, it's really, really good. Tom, we have a lot of stuff to talk about tonight, but we have a dope giveaway planned for this evening. Tom, take it away. Tell us what we're giving away tonight.
We are giving away tonight this amazing G Fuel bundle that comes with the shaker. It's a new flavor, Tetris Blast.
Mm.
But the best part is here, ladies and gentlemen, is that we were able to purchase that via Boots, who is now out here in the chat. She just recently been partnered with G Fuel.
Yep.
And we used her code to pick this up to give away for everybody to give her support because she's been an awesome friend I've gotten to know very well over the last few years. Somebody I confide in sometimes, trust, and like bounce things off. And you know, she's an amazing person. If you're not checking her out on Twitter or Instagram, Booty Haver, I know for sure on Twitter. I want to say it's probably the same on Instagram. Bear with me on that one. But you know, we appreciate you, Boots. I've gotten to know you slowly over time through just being a customer in retail, and it was one of those kind of transitions. But you know, I truly value your time, your knowledge, thoughts, words, everything. But we're just glad to support you. So we want to do this for you as well, too. So also, if you enjoy some G Fuel and you want to take advantage of getting some G Fuel with a 10% code discount, here's the way to do it. Just go to the checkout, hit that promo code, capital B-O-O-T-Z. Boom, 10% off your purchase. So
got it.
Yep. They've got some new flavors out there. They're adding some new stuff. I've been drinking G Fuel for a few years now, on and off, and I will honestly say, when I logged in after she got partnered, I was like, okay, what am I going to buy? They've got quite a variety now. The one I keep thinking about and can't stop thinking about is the Sonic flavor, which it sounds like it's like peachos, like the little peach rings that you get in the
ooh
packages. Yeah, so sign me up for that.
Oh,
so
really?
Yeah, so.
That sounds tasty. No, Boots, thank you. Seriously, you're always a part of the conversation. You're always in the chat. You're always supporting us, and we just want to support you in every which way that we can. And this thing is fucking dope. Comes with a shaker and everything. So good to go. Giving that away. Exclamation point, enter. Yes, Cuddles. You can enter in this one if you want to, buddy. We'll give Cuddles a green light on this one.
Yeah, absolutely.
Get in there, Cuddles. But yeah, we're excited to give this away. And like Tone said, if you're looking for some G Fuel, head over to the site. Use Boots, B-O-O-T-Z. Get your 10% discount.
You.
So really excited to be giving this away. Thanks again, Boots, for letting us promote you. We were really excited to see you get partnered. You're entertaining as hell. She posts some fucking hilarious
videos on
Twitter.
You guys, if you
got
to follow her socials, if you want to drop them in here too, that's fine as well, of course, Boots. But honestly, you guys, if you want some quality, top-notch posting and entertainment,
she's hilarious.
Look no further.
She is absolutely hilarious. And she does some good cosplay too. She does some really good cosplay. So make sure you check her out. Tone, what the fuck have you been doing? We had a long weekend.
We did.
No, you didn't. I did. Sorry. You had a regular weekend, but what have you been up to?
Well, so honestly, work's going, it's just been busy. You know, we got a lot going on our plate, which is fine. I love the job. I absolutely adore the people I work with. So no complaints there. Last Saturday, actually was kind of a audible, I called. I originally kind of wanted to go to that Polish festival that was going on in
Bay
City.
Yes.
The weather here, everybody.
Is it Stan Fest?
Yeah, I think so.
Seen Sam Fest.
Yeah. I really wanted some pierogies and Polish dogs. However, what I didn't want to deal with was what apparently nobody told me was that I moved to San Antonio because it's been nothing but fucking humidity. Yesterday, the day before, it was like 90% humidity. I'm not shitting you. It's what we call soup pants, ladies and gentlemen. Soup pants is too much humidity, and it feels like you've got a bowl of soup, warm soup, in your crotch.
It is not that guy-friendly stuff.
It's terrible.
I'm not a big fan of the humidity here in Michigan right now. Like, you literally walk out. I would say walking out to the mailbox is sweating in July and June is different for me, but I do it in February. I just naturally sweat a lot, but the humidity makes it even worse.
It's been terrible. So what we did was Arkenrath and myself, we just kind of popped around town, and we hit up a lot of local stores, some local, some maybe literally only one, maybe two major chains. I said I was stimulating the local economy,
yes,
which
you
is what
are.
I did.
You're doing your part.
I went to Five Below for the first time ever and couldn't find what I was looking for in the decor area. However, I did find some very unique candies. It's the first time I've ever seen a gummy octopus, and I'll tell you what, I was really excited about that.
A gummy octopus?
Bag of gummy octopuses. Wow. So, anyways, but I bought some decor at this one store, did this, stopped in, spent some money, but the last place I stopped at, which was really exciting for me, hadn't been there since before pandemic, at least.
Oh,
it had been a while.
Yeah.
As one of the local comic book shops here, Coy's Comics here,
Coy's
Bay Road
Comics.
Here in Saginaw. Steve's owned it for many years now at this point.
Where at on Bay Road?
That's kind of right across from, I have no fucking idea, but it's on Bay Road before Shattuck, I think, between like Shattuck and like,
oh, yeah. Okay, yeah.
I can't remember. But anyways, he bought the extra space over there and made it bigger. This place is legit. He's done a great job with it. Matter of fact, I saw him in there too. He's like, hey, Tony, what's going on? Mm-hmm. Like, oh, what's up, dude? Nice to see you. Tons of action figures, Funko. I mean, just doing their thing in there too. They were celebrating Pride Month. Yep. It was their Pride weekend sale, so it was 10% off anything in the store. It was an amazing experience once again to be able to go to local stores and have that ability again, but also a fantastic comic book shop. So I've got a pull list I'm starting up here real soon. I'm going to kind of get back into one or two titles because I did pick up number one, a Berserker, which is the...
Oh, you grabbed Berserker.
Yeah, which is the one that Keanu Reeves is involved in writing. So
he's actually writing it?
He's involved in the writing of that. Pretty cool.
When you say he's involved, like, is he writing or is he like... Does he just provide like, whoa?
Maybe. I don't know. But yeah, so I don't know how deep... He's in the
This is where we
process,
want to put a whoa right
Right,
here.
Right. The character definitely kind of looks like him. So, but anyways, it was really exciting. So that's what I've been up to outside of playing some games here and there when I got some time. But it was just really exciting to have the ability to do that again. So Coy's Comics in Saginaw, if you're into comics and you're in the Tri-City area, wherever it may be, hit them up, check them out. Great vibe in there, like always. But Store looks great. They've expanded. It looks like you're in like a Comic-Con booth. There's so much awesome stuff there. I love it.
Yeah, you were telling me, you were saying in the Discord that the shop is really pristine. Like it's a nice,
it's a good looking
shop inside.
Yeah, it's gorgeous. So, but it's great to have that kind of place around.
Crash says it's by the old Pizza Hut Hollywood video. I know that's exactly where it's at.
Yeah, yep. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Movie Danner says Reeves has great hair. He really does, man. Keanu Reeves always has that long, luscious, dark hair. Really nice. I wish I had that. I have a shitty hairline and I'm going bald. So male pattern balding, that's cool too, right?
I don't know.
I mean, I don't need flowing hair. I got
never heard of it.
It's I want to get to your point. I want to get to your level. I got the horseshoe going on kind of with like a little bit here. It just looks, that's why I wear the hat.
Easy to get to the level, man. Just grab
makes me look shoe. Cool with the hat. If I don't wear the hat, you almost want to call the cops. You're like, why is this guy near kids? Really bad. Doesn't look good. Ooh, excuse me. This stuff is very, excuse me. Let's see. I was off for a week. I got a lot of gaming in. I started playing Scarlet Nexus, which is a very interesting game. I'm going to play a little bit more before I talk about it, but it's a beautiful-looking game, and it runs great. The combat very deep, and it can be a little overwhelming at times. But I really dug what I've played so far. It's the presentation is phenomenal. It's a beautiful-looking game, and the way that, like, the anime presentation, it's pretty dope.
Looks
like,
cool.
It's really, really good so far, so I've been enjoying that. And I smoked my first piece of meat in my new electric smoker that I got for Christmas. Very happy with it. Josh Quake says, are you playing Scarlet with controller or I'm playing with controller? I'm playing on PS5. I don't even know if I'd want to play that game with keyboard and mouse with everything that's going on. But I have no idea. I'm not a PC gamer. So, I mean, I'm sure a skilled person can play with keyboard and mouse, but I've really enjoyed it with controller. If I tried playing that with a keyboard and mouse, I'd probably just fucking break my PC. Not that good with keyboard and mouse. It is what it is. But yeah, I smoked my first pork butt and it turned out actually pretty good. I'm doing another one this Friday, for a cookout at my in-laws. So I'm going to smoke that all day.
And present your meats upon somebody.
I'm going to present my meat to my in-laws. I'm really excited about it. I learned a couple of things from my first go at it. I'm going to try some different stuff, but I am finally smoking stuff. And I'm telling you, dude, the first time I did it, which was the Friday before I went on vacation, dude, I went in the garage and I had it in there. And, dude, it's the first time I've ever had that when I walk out in the garage. And it's just like, oh, there it is. That I've been craving that smoke, that smoke smell. And it was exquisite. I was really, really excited about it. And I'm going to do it again on Friday. I'm going to take it the next time. I'll try it with another pork butt. But I've also got some chicken drums I want to try doing soon.
I hear chicken's the way to go.
I want to do some smoked chicken. I want to do a smoked salmon. And then ultimately, I want to get to ribs. I feel I'm scared to rush into ribs because I don't want to fuck up ribs. I want to get, you know, handle stuff like pork butts and some chicken stuff here. I even want to do some salmon. And see, and all these guys are like, ribs are the easiest. That's why I'm scared. Because if I fuck it up, then I'm just going to stop smoking altogether. Like, I'm done. I feel like I want to fuck everything else up and then get to ribs. I want to fuck it. Look at all these guys. 3, 2, 1. Yeah. See, Seven Jones says, you can't mess it up. Yes, I can. I really, really can. And I don't want to.
From what I've heard, ribs are actually not that hard to do.
Great. See, guy doesn't even smoke, says it's easy. So maybe I am overreacting, but it's really not possible. I feel like Dungeons is daring me. Like he's setting me up right now. He's like, no, it's really not possible. I will be the first person in history. If you can smoke a butt, ribs or nothing. Okay, well, Tricky says so. Then I believe Tricky. I believe Dungeons. I'm still going to start with smoke butt, get to chicken, and then ultimately get to ribs. I want to do a ribs for like a bunch of people. So I get a couple slabs, get them in there.
And then everybody judge.
And then everyone judged me. How? And then Seven Dungeons comes up and he judges it. And he's like, wow, I was wrong. You really fucked it up. I do want to do a brisket as well. Actually, I'm pumped, dude. 4th of July weekend, obviously coming up on Sunday, going to Freezy's house. There, a buddy that I play Destiny 2 with, he is smoking a brisket. He's coming up. He's coming down to Saginaw to smoke a brisket.
Springstorm.
Another guy, the neighbor, Jarrett, he is going to be, I guess he's smoking ribs. And then Rob is going to have shit on his Blackstone and whatever else he's doing. I'm going to eat like a fucking king on Sunday. I'm not even going to stay awake. Yeah, see, Freezy's doing brisket. I'm going to Freezy's house. there's gonna be fireworks. I'm gonna be asleep. You know what? You know what happens when I eat a bunch of meat? When we went down to
you get the meat sweats and you pass out.
I pass the fuck out.
Hey Freezy, when I get home, I'm gonna check my mailbox for the invite. By the way, snail mail. I figure, you know, it's easier.
I'm telling you, man. I'm going to eat like a king, and then everyone's like, Brent, what are you bringing? I'm gonna bring my appetite, probably some salt and pepper. Freezy, I think the wifey's gonna make a cheese ball. He loves my wife's cheese balls. They're phenomenal. He speaks so highly of them. Dude, be getting the sweats. I do get the sweats, man. Whenever I eat that, but I mean, how much did we spend at Dr. Rose Barbecue? We bought a bunch of shit.
We had quite the
spread. Yeah, it was pretty ridiculous. We got the good fireworks this year. Oh man, yeah. Breezy went out and just he bought a bunch. It's gonna be a show on Sunday. It's gonna be a display. Good food, good fireworks. I'm gonna miss the fireworks because I'm gonna pass out from the food.
Pass out.
Gonna suck, but I'm gonna be eating good. I can't wait. Oh, Freezy, you're in the chat. Any update
on 99 Pharmacy?
The most important. See, he knows how my wife makes the cheese. Extra garlic powder, extra garlic salt, whatever. But we need an update, dude. We need an update on 99 Cafe. If you can provide anything, if you want to say, dude, we'll be open July 5th. I'm off that day. I'm gonna come over and order like 10 Burnham sandwiches.
Yeah, I'll check after I get my invite.
I seriously just keep thinking about this, like, because he put up a thing on Facebook. They had a Facebook thing, hey, we're hiring.
Yeah,
so I was like, that. They got to be getting close.
Yeah, let's hopefully
they got to be getting close. Mm-hmm. I was actually gonna text to it and be like, I'm not interested in a job, but when are you guys opening? Can I order a sandwich with this? I decided not to. I don't want to be a funny guy. I would also like an invite. I can't come, but still, well, everyone's invited to Freezy's house. There we go. Everyone's invited to Freezy's house. Give me a good time.
There.
Did we cover everything? We got the giveaway going right now. If you want to enter in, !! Get yourself a chance to win this Tetris Blast G Fuel. Going to be pretty hot. We're drinking Bean Flicker S'mores. Move into our first topic.
Do it.
First thing we're going to talk about tonight, we've been playing a game with Tricky Regent and Seven Dungeons. We've been playing D&D's Dark Alliance, which is available now on PlayStation 5. Xbox Series X via Game Pass, which is the way you should probably go with this right now. PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and PC. Let's talk about D&D Dark Alliance, Tone. First of all, I'm gonna come to you first because I'm going to get your thoughts, your initial reactions, other than the fact that you're tired of being cyberbullied. We are still in inspection, probably, hopefully, the 12th of July. I'm going to be there on July 11th, and I'm camping out, Freezy. No bullshit. But, Tone, I know you've been dying to talk about Dark Alliance. Your initial impressions of Dark Alliance, my friend. Ooh, El Blanco, 4 out of 10. Wow. Oh, boy.
This is a tough one. Rarely, first of all, do I get a game that I've wanted probably for 20 years or more, solely because I've been invested in these characters for many, many decades at this point. These are based off characters that as a 14, 15-year-old kid, you know, started reading these books even after they originally came out. So like early 90s, maybe even late 80s for like the original trilogy. So, it's somebody who also read Lord of the Rings back then, and R.A. Salvatore, the author of these characters. I've met him twice. He took inspiration from Lord of the Rings. He's a huge Tolkien fan.
Oh, man.
Really excited. A lot of deep-rooted things for, you know, childhood Tone here. So I was really excited to play it due to that, to be able to play Dritz to Duerden, of House Duerden.
Drizzt, you mean?
Eighth House of Menzel Baron Zan. But, man, it's rarely do I get to play a game that... This game sucks, and I'm pissed about it.
Oh, God!
And I'm pissed.
That's harsh.
Listen.
That's harsh.
It fucking sucks, man. Like, I don't know how else to say it. Like, God. Listen. There's a lot of potential here.
Tons.
Yeah, it is 10 out of 10 Moss with the friends. You're right. Unless you're with which you guys are probably, you know, don't play with a bunch of cyber bullies, but it would be it would be much funner. Listen, there's this game should not have come out this year. This game should have been through a lot more of the R&D or wherever they needed somebody
QA,
yeah, not R&D, but somebody needed to sit there and play test it a little bit. Like I just keep thinking of Grandma's Boy and somebody sitting there, you know, letting grandma play it for a little bit, because I think she could probably, you know, put something forth a little bit better than these guys have put out so far. I agree right now. If you've got both systems, play it on the fucking Xbox. Play it for free. Game Pass, PC, wherever it is.
Play it for the better flags, too. The flags actually way better.
I'm sure. Xbox. Like, listen, it is enjoyable. I do have fun playing it with friends. There's a lot of things here that has a lot of potential. Even the grind is right. But there is so much missing from even the simplest of quality of life things. It's 2021. There's things that this game doesn't do that they've been doing in games for decades. Mm-hmm. Just for the sheer presence of quality of life. It doesn't exist. Now, will I continue to play it? Yes, I'm going to keep playing it from time to time. I'm trying to enjoy it. Don't get me wrong. I do enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
It's the combat is actually fun. It's mm-hmm. it's enjoyable.
Depends on who you're playing as.
Yeah, I think there's degrees of that.
There is.
You know, the armor system, everything has a lot of potential. I like, you know, everything about what this game wants to do, but it just doesn't do that. And that's very frustrating. Movie Tanner says, first game released directly to the toilet. I don't know if I'd go that far, but I tell you what, it definitely came out and it was in the bathroom for sure.
Yeah.
It was definitely on the counter about ready to fall in the toilet. Like, listen, and it hurts me to say this and to talk about it like this because I was really excited about this game because I love the other Dark Alliance games. And, again, you know, we were sold on something that was going to have a lot of potential. The story's kind of cool, too, even though they kind of play with the canon of the story. Like, they really put some effort in some areas of this game. Right. But longevity's a huge concern of mine so far already. I mean, you can grind for your armor sets for what?
Some decent the final tier perks are actually pretty good.
Yeah, perks, but for what? Like the dungeons? Okay, well, what are those going to look like? You know what I mean? Like no one's been able to touch the dungeons, I don't think. Yeah, you got to.
Are those the red ones?
Yeah, those are actual dungeons.
I'm one level away from getting that. I've completed one story of mission.
And
left.
That's awesome. So, like, we still need some more time with it, but honestly, just right now at this point, like, I'll play it when everybody's playing it. I'm not going to spend time doing it with pugs. I'm not going to grind outside of playing it with friends. I'm not going to play it by myself. I've got other games I can play. You know, like I said, if you've got a chance to play it for free on Game Pass. Again, I want to be really excited about it. There's again, just like Marvel Avengers, like the gameplay in Marvel's right now, I would almost rather play Marvel Avengers right now overall. I enjoy that because there's way more customization in there, at least on maybe the powers and some of the stats or whatever. But,
sure.
But this just definitely kind of came out as a dud for me. So,
you know, the first thing that came to mind after a couple of sessions playing this game is, why the fuck could they not get a more? I don't want to be mean to the developer because honestly, before this, I've never heard of 2K Studios. It's Tuke or 2K T U Q U E. I've never even heard of them before. But I can't help but wonder what this game would be like if it was made by a more competent developer at this time. And I'm not trying to be like a jerk, but I mean, this game has, like, first of all, I'll start with the positives. You want to play this with friends. You want to play this cooperatively. Playing it solo sucks. It's not fun. The enemy AI is atrocious in this game. Look, I have played Call of Duty Black Ops Declassified on PlayStation Vita. This AI rivals that for stupidity. Absolute stupidity. It is I agree with Dungeons. It's some of the worst I have ever seen. Playing it like as Wolfgar or Bruner or even Drist is probably a little bit more fun because you have to charge in and actually activate combat, you know, to engage. If you're playing as Cattie-Brie, you can literally stay back and just fire your bow nonstop or wait till your stamina to recharge from a distance, and you're hitting them and hitting them and hitting them, and it doesn't, they don't come after you. They don't get, you know, aggro at all. They just stand there. It's hilarious. They stand there and they keep talking to each other. The dialogue is on the screen like, oh, Kessler's doing what? And you're just like popping everybody with bows. I hit an 800-hit combo up against, I don't know if that first level, I don't know if you remember where the big guys, there's a bunch of other like goblins there. There's one big dude. I stood back at a distance and just fired my bow until I got an 800-hit combo. I wiped out the entire crew without being attacked once. It's that bad. It is terrible AI. But it is fun playing cooperatively. The class-based stuff, I really dig. Everyone has their own different perks and their own different play styles. I do like playing as Wolfgar, Cattie-Brie. I'm still not sold on her yet. Some of her moves are pretty good. Her support stuff is really, really nice.
Needs some balancing.
But needs some balancing, especially with the stamina. The stamina system in that game is really, really wonky. And the game looks and runs good. It's a pretty looking game. You know, the level designs are really good. There's a lot of hidden areas throughout the levels. Like, I really dig that stuff. But yeah, man, when it comes down to it, it's buggy as fuck. The AI is shit. It's UI is terrible. The explanation of the classes and the mechanics and your abilities and some of the buffs and debuffs, they don't explain shit. Nothing. And it's just like, what the fuck does this even mean? Dude, there's a team attack? Nobody knows how to do it. And it pops up on the screen for like a split second, and it's just like, okay, I don't know what I'm supposed to do here.
Wasn't explained.
It doesn't explain anything. And if you're playing solo and you hop into the matchmaking queue, it's fucking terrible. Because like, I'm like, when I first started jumping with Cattie-Brie, I'm like level one. And it's like, hey, here's some people who are level five and eight, and go play with them. I'm getting my ass kicked. I'm just like, what the fuck is this? It is an incomplete game, but damn it. The potential, like you said, is so there. I want, like, the concept is great. The concept is really, really there. It's there. But, man, the execution is just flawed.
Like,
horribly.
Even dumb shit. Like,
dumb shit. When you're
in the menus, like, or, like, when you're trying to upgrade your shit, you have to, like, so you got, like, your cape. You have to go into the cape menu separately to select the cape you have equipped to upgrade. Why wouldn't you just, like, upgrade it when you're, like, in the menu? Like, there's so much, like, things that you're, like, why was that even a choice? Like, why would you make that harder or waste more time doing things like that? Man. Like, it's so much
little
shit.
There's so many
like
odd choices. And then I think they talked about, was it Drassen posted in the chat about the changes that they're going to make? Where they're like, hey, one of the things we're going to do is, like, now you can choose any character you want. You can have, like, four Cattie-Bries. I feel like that's, like, the last thing they should be thinking about doing. I actually like the fact that you can only choose one of each character. Because the AI is so stupid. If you have four Cattie-Bries, you don't have to do anything.
Right.
The whole team can sit back and just and snipe everybody, and you just get all the best loot, finish all the missions, and I have to engage combat at all. The last thing you need to do is allow everybody to choose whoever the fuck they want to choose. No! Keep it that... Don't worry about that!
I would like to know certain things like, oh, I don't know, certain characters, even the minions on certain tiers. Like, I get it. You're going to go up in tiers. Things are going to be harder.
Yeah.
But, like, these one-hit fucking kills. And it's not just me that deals with, like, I've seen, you know, Drassen get dropped in one-hit fucking kills.
Yeah, well, I mean, you guys are weak as fuck, but.
Just generally, says the guy that's, like, you know, in a whole fucking area of the map.
Because
shooting.
I'm playing smarter, not harder.
You have a fucking bow. How would that be smarter?
Not my problem.
That's just how, yeah, right.
Not
okay.
My problem.
No, seriously. there's a lot, even the combat is just so fucking, like, the combat is fun and has, again, has potential, but, like, certain ways, like, okay, the AI is dumb, but then all of a sudden the AI is, like,
super, like, all of a super sudden, powerful, yeah.
Yeah, like,
there's, like, the difficulty the spike just goes to the roof.
Right,
yeah.
Like, the Verbeeg are, like, ridiculously, like, mobile. Yeah, the dodges aren't perfect.
Yeah, the windows of the dodge are, they're inconsistent. Because there's sometimes where I'm playing as Cattie-Brie and I can dodge out of the way and I don't get hit.
Right.
And I'm, as they're swinging through my dodge, I'm like, okay, cool, I'm good. And then there's other times where I'm dodging and through the dodge, they hit and kill me. I'm like, what the fuck is, am I not dodging? What kind of a window is it? It's so inconsistent.
Yeah, so there's a lot of, clearly, as you can see, there's a lot of issues. It wants to be good. Hopefully sometime in the next 5 years when it's properly beta tested, we'll be beta testing apparently for the next couple of years. I don't know how long, but, you know, I can't believe this is actually released. Like, it's pretty frustrating. Like, they've got a lot of potential, but, like, Wizards of the Coast should be going, hey, motherfuckers, we let you have our license. What the fuck is this?
Right.
Like, I want to know what that conversation is like. Or are they just like, sweet, thanks for the fucking moolah.
I mean, that's the thing. Like... The developer, like I said, these levels are really, there's a lot to them. They're really cool.
They're built really well.
The only thing I would say that it's disappointing me about the level is some of the secret areas, like the puzzles, they're fucking stupid. There's like, they're not difficult at all.
No, but the design is cool.
Yeah, like, I like the fact that they're there. I just wish some of them are a little bit more thought-provoking stuff. As someone who gamed too seriously, it was one of the harder games to watch you guys play. It was, too, man. It was just, oh, as someone who doesn't play, yeah. No, it was... Like I said, there are moments where you're having fun, but more often than not, you're just either let down by weird bugs or shitty AI or just inexplicable deaths. Oh, so you're just like, I don't understand what's happening.
So apparently it's 2010 or something again, or I don't know, maybe even earlier. But like when something pops out of a treasure chest, I have to physically hit a button to pick it up. The fuck
yeah,
is
why
that?
Can't you just run over it?
What year is it?
Well, it maybe it wouldn't be so bad if the button prompts actually, you know, worked.
Yeah, there's definitely a delay on that, too.
Oh,
yeah,
dude, not even delay. It just does. Like, there's times where I would run up to the ladder, and it says press, you know, across to climb, and I'm hitting it, and all of a sudden I'm like, oh, my warmth is gone. I'm not freezing to death. And I'm hitting. I'm like, will you fucking jump? So there's a whole lot of shit that needs to get addressed, and I really, really hope that they can do it because there are moments where it's kind of fun. It's kind of fun. I heard Tone is going to be cold for Halloween. I heard that too.
Want to talk about Mortal Kombat?
No, don't want to. I think you're doing your own. I think you're doing your best right now. I think you're doing just as good with this game. But I mean, at the end of the day, it's got potential. But I would not feel comfortable. You know, somebody hopped into a stream I was doing the other day. And they're like, "Hey, would you recommend this?" I'm like, "On Game Pass, yeah." If you have Game Pass, it's worth a look. If you're playing anywhere else, it's hard to recommend this for $39.99. It's really difficult to recommend at that price.
Yeah, somebody call me sometime when the game's done. So that's about the next time I want to play. So.
Did you really delete it?
On the next topic.
Is it because you were getting cyberbullied by Drassen? I don't know. Dungeons is a prick, dude. He's a mean dude. But yeah, hopefully it gets addressed. Hopefully they can fix it. I hope they focus on something more than allowing everybody to play as Cattie-Brie. That's not an issue that needs to be addressed right now. You have a whole shitload of other stuff that needs to get fixed. Worry about that, then come back to ruin the game some other way. So, all right, moving on to our next topic. A movie review, Tone. A movie that's been out for a little while, but people started talking about in the chat, and we were like, oh, yeah, we should probably watch this because it sounds pretty dope. Let's talk about The Platform. This is available now on Netflix. It's been out for, I think it came out in like 2019, just before the pandemic hit. This is directed by, I'm going to butcher this, Galder Gazula Urusha. That sound good? That sounds kind of close. That's a big name.
From Ghostbusters?
But this is a very interesting movie. It's a horror movie. That's what it's listed as. But it's also a social commentary with a lot of symbolism. There's a lot of things that you can take away from this movie and apply it to real life and things that we're all going through as a society. But it's a horror film about a vertical prison called The Pit or The Hole, and it's got one cell per level. It's vertical. And there's two inmates per cell, and there's a food platform that drops down between all the cells, and it stops at each cell for 2 minutes. And everyone can eat whatever they want, and it just continues to work its way down the prison. Once you think about in just in general, you're like, man, that's fucked up. That's a fucked up premise. But there's a lot more going on with this movie. But Tony, I want to get your thoughts first, just in the movie in general, before we get into kind of like the social commentary of this movie. Overall thoughts of just the general presentation of the movie.
I really, really enjoyed this movie. You know, of course, I didn't know a whole lot going into it. I hadn't heard about it before, weirdly as it is. And I definitely was hoping for some gore, which we got a little bit of gore as well, too, which I appreciate.
There's a good substantial amount of gore.
Yeah, I actually really, really dug the entire time watching. I was very into the movie because, like, I could tell right away that, okay, this is going to be this wants you, like, it's presenting itself the way it is, but it's going to be kind of a thinker. Like, they want you to kind of look at it differently. And you start to kind of pick that up maybe right away, I suppose. I thought the conversations and the characters were very all unique.
Yep.
I liked
thought-provoking stuff. I said, in a horror movie element, it all works good. But when you start thinking outside the box and you think about comparisons to like just life
just
in general.
Life in general, yeah. You start kind of thinking about things like that. You know, the main guy, like the old guy's kind of giving you the background of everything that's going on. It was like
obviously
he was a very interesting character. But yeah, I honestly the entire time I was like completely glued. I wanted to finish it, and once I finished it, I'm like, now I gotta talk about it, because like I think I connected these dots, but I'm not sure about some of these dots. There's some dots I still haven't connected that I feel like I need to explore some.
There's a lot of room for interpretation.
It's the book still has, like, I feel like that I'm missing something in the book. I feel like I should know that tale better. And
you're talking about Don Quixote?
The
protagonist in the movie, he, like, you're allowed to bring one item into the prison.
It doesn't matter the item.
anything.
People can bring knives,
a knife,
or
a sword, anything.
Whatever.
And my man brings in a copy of Don Quixote.
If he's gonna read a couple times while he's in there, or whatever.
Right, right.
But yeah, I really was shocked by the movie overall. Of course, I love gore, so I was happy to have some of that. But man, you know, the one thing that really puzzled me about the whole thing is gonna be really random, and I'm gonna pass it back over. Only thing that bothered me the entire time that I couldn't figure out was how did the fucking platform operate? Was that like
magic?
Was that like using like magnetism of some sort? Like a like how magnets, if you do the opposite ends, it kind of makes it so things can float. Like how? Because like I don't know who could watch that movie. I feel like and not go, where the fuck's the cord?
I mean, this is obviously way in the future, so I'm assuming I think magnetism.
Is it way in the future?
My understanding was, I thought it was.
I didn't think it really was. I think it was like kind of modern day-ish.
Oh, really?
I didn't feel like it was anything that was like, you know, way in the future.
Aliens.
Right, aliens. Right. Yeah, I don't know. That was
question.
Puzzling. That was really
I guess
puzzling.
Magnetism is probably the best way.
I mean, maybe that's a
it.
Weird random thing to think about, but like for me, when it comes to things like that on like a pseudo technical or scientific level, I'm looking at them like, how the fuck is that platform even working? Like, it
right.
just didn't, yeah, it had to be magnets. So like, but like at the same time, if you jumped in the middle of it, there I'd feel like there would be some, either some resistance or something. Like, I couldn't figure that out. That was driving me nuts. But I digress.
This movie is all about symbolism and social commentary. My man's trying to figure out how the platform moves up and down.
Bothering the shit out of me.
Wow, that's fucking
big
sweet.
Time.
No, just to kind of go along with Tone said, I thought the setting was incredibly eerie and very disturbing. There are some very gory scenes, and some of them involve knives. And, you know, I can watch a movie where people get shot up or blown to pieces, but when it comes to knives and cutting skin and just doing that, it gets to me, you know? Yeah. I watched the movie, though. But yeah, it's going good performances all around. It's a foreign film, so you got subtitles, but everyone is just very convincing in the roles. It's very, very good in that regard. But yeah, this whole movie is a social commentary, and for the most part, up until the ending, I feel like regarding a character and the message being sent, we'll kind of get into that in a moment. I feel like that is the only part that didn't quite connect like the rest of the movie was, right. Trying to connect the dots with society and the movie. The ending was a little bit kind of like, I didn't really understand that part of it. But for the most part, the movie is a social commentary. And basically what it is, Tony, you know, the way a lot of people are looking at it, and I think this is the way it was intended to be viewed, is you look at the prison as either society or government, okay? And then you look at, like, the floors, the top floor. Obviously, they get the platform first, so they have this whole spread of amazing food. And then it drops down every 2 minutes to the floor below and the floor below, and there's some 300-plus levels in this prison. So you imagine, as you're getting lower down in the prison, there's not a whole lot of food left, and you have to resort to a lot of other ways to eat, and it's like, kind of like how you look at society now. You have the upper 1% who has everything, and they can eat as much as they want and enjoy it and not share it with anybody and not consider the folks below them, all the way down to the folks who are just fighting for scraps. Dog-eat-dog world. You know, just the poverty-stricken, no sign of hope, just the bleakest hell at the lowest level. So you have this interesting, like, correlation with how things are right now in this world, in this society. There's the rich, there's the people that don't have anything. And it's interesting how in the movie, people bounce around between the floors. Like every month, you change which floor you're on. And you watch these people who start at the top, and then they drop all the way down to the bottom or the lower levels. And everyone's attitude changes. You know, they get down at the bottom and they're like, oh, this is bullshit, it's not fair, and they fight and whatnot, but then they get to the top and they forget what they've just been through. And it's just about, well, I'm going to eat everything. I'm not going to share anything. I'm going to eat everything because I'm up here. And you just have this scrappy, dog-eat-dog world, and there's a lot to think about. And the protagonist, Goring, he's just kind of like trying to figure out what's going on. He's kind of like the resistance. You know, he's like, okay, look, I'm going to try to make change. I'm going to try to change things. And he goes through this process and, you know, he kind of just slips into madness as well. Like, he's got a lot going on. He's been there for, I think he's there over the course. I think he switches rooms like 5 or 6 times. So yeah, 6 months.
Is it 3 months?
I'd say 4 or 5 months because he changes. Like,
he was only in there for 3 and then he got his degree.
Well,
maybe it was 6.
Yeah, I think it was like 6 or so. Whatever, but yeah. Like, he's bounced around. So he represents like the resistance. Like, I'm gonna make changes if it costs me my life. And
yeah.
The way it plays out, it's sort of interpreted that way. But it's just, it's a really interesting movie because as a standalone horror film, it's an awesome idea. It's an awesome concept. But then when you apply it to society here now, you're just like, fuck, man, that's actually thought-provoking stuff.
Hell yeah.
And I thought that was the most interesting thing about this movie. It's like, it's a horror movie, but there's a whole lot more to interpret from this movie. And I thought that was great.
Yeah, that was definitely the more I felt like you watched that, the more there's a good chance you were going to start really kind of catching on to being like, oh, I see what's going on here.
Yeah, because like at first glance, generally, you're just like, okay, that's the rich, that's the poor. But then when you start looking at
right.
the things people are doing and even just items that people have, you're just like, what does that represent? What does this represent? What group of people does this represent? What actions does this represent? And you just, it's thought-provoking. It's really interesting how this movie plays out and gets you thinking outside the box.
How was this received? Did we check into that? I don't remember. Overall.
I want to say it was received pretty well. I didn't look at the Metacritic, but I do remember when it came out, there was a lot of hype behind it. There was a lot of people like, oh, man, this movie's really, really good.
I want to say like users were like high 80s or something like that, I think.
This strikes me as the type of movie that'd be better off with user ratings as opposed to critical ratings, because there's probably certain things that look like there's probably critics going, how does the platform move up and down? Up 1 star. So, you never know. It's on Netflix, Cuddles. It is on Netflix.
Just, you know, it was hard to suspend my disbelief at that point when it came to the fucking platform. I'll be very honest. I was very, very bothered by that. I was hoping somebody had an answer for that. If any engineers or rocket scientists are out there, maybe I'll have to hit up my friend Space Cadet, see if she can tell me, because I was quite curious on how that thing moved. But again, I digress on that.
Well, I bet you were just a peach to sit through Doctor Strange, huh? How does that happen?
Whoa.
I love it because this horror isn't creepy slasher monster. It's the horror of society. That's what makes it such an interesting premise in a great movie, because it's two things. It's a really creepy horror film. Like, it's a psychological horror film that makes you think. But
yes.
Then when you compare it to society, the social commentary, it's super unique. It's very unique in that regard. And if you don't mind foreign films with subtitles, it actually has voiceover. It has yeah, it's dub. It's got an English dub. Did you watch it in the...
Watch it in sub.
Did you really?
Oh, yeah.
I want an English dub.
Anytime I get a chance to watch anything in its native language with subs, I'm going to watch it in subs.
Do you? Okay.
Absolutely.
Right. No. Actually, and no, the thing is, lately, probably for the last 4 years, since I've been streaming,
yeah.
People are like, hey, can you turn on the subtitles so I can read the subs in case I'm watching or I step away? I watch, like, everything with subs. Even the platform. Even though I had the English dub on, I had the subs on.
Yeah, I used to live in an apartment in, like, the early 2000s. You learn real fast. Use subtitles.
That makes it easier. Especially, actually, you know what? This week's Loki, when the timekeepers were talking, I was like, I'm going to need subtitles for this.
That's part of the reason why. It actually now has transcended, because it's making sure I'm catching all the dialogue. Cuddles, that is...
Cuddles watches porn with sub. That's fucking great, dude. Right. My grandma uses closed captions, too. Me and your grandma would get along just fine. She's a very cultured woman.
Yes.
I dig it. But no, I would love for anybody in here that hasn't seen yet, watch this movie and chime in, whether it's on YouTube or in our Discord. We want to hear from you guys and girls. I mean, this is a very thought-provoking movie. It's a horror film, but there's a lot going on here, and there's a lot of room for interpretation. I would love to get you guys and girls' thoughts on this. I mean, seriously, chime in. If you get a chance to watch this, share your thoughts. We want to talk about it. We want to get you guys and girls' thoughts. I think it's one of those movies where it could stimulate a really good group conversation.
Absolutely.
So.
Recommend. Definitely recommend.
Highly recommend. Available now on Netflix. Check it out. I think you will dig it. All right, Tone. How you doing? You doing all right?
Good. I'm ready for these fucking trailers.
We have.
Ready.
A quartet. Is it quartet?
Quartet.
4 trailers we got to talk about tonight. And these trailers are fucking awesome. All of them are awesome. So. We're going to jump into the first one right now, and the most important one, because it stars the one true God.
The master of the cinematic paradigm.
King Cuddle's favorite actor of all time, Nicolas Cage. Let's check out the trailer for Pig.
God.
Just Canadian. That's sad. Oh, he's got a truffle pig.
For a truffle pig.
Looking for a truffle pig.
Someone stole.
I don't understand.
Tell me who you are.
You made the right choice being out there in the woods. There's nothing here for you anymore. There's really nothing here for most of us. Buy yourself a new pig.
What are you thinking?
I remember every meal I ever cooked. I remember every person I ever served. You live your life for them, and they don't even see you. You don't even see yourself. Things to really care about. Who has my pig?
Who has my pig? Somebody has taken Nick Cage's truffle pig, and he wants to know who and why. Tone?
Yeah.
We don't know much about this movie other than this synopsis. A truffle hunter who lives in the Oregonian wilderness must return to his past in Portland in search of his beloved pig after she's kidnapped. That's all we have. That's all we have on this movie. But it's Nicolas Cage, and I gotta believe if there's a reason he signed up for it, there's something about the movie. And I looked this up. Nick Cage decided to produce it because he felt it shared similarities with two of his more recent critically acclaimed films, Joe
and
Mandy.
Mandy.
So, I don't know what the fuck this movie's about. I got John Wick vibes. Somebody killed, you know, John Wick's dog. Somebody kidnapped Nick Cage's truffle pig. And that's it. That's the only motivation he needs. He wants to find his pig. According to Nick Cage, it's a drama with one of his most stable performances. Now, does that mean we'll get to see, is there going to be no Cage rage? We don't know. There's a couple scenes in the trailer where it looks like he's, you know, he's getting wound up. But for the most part, it's a very subtle performance, what we saw in the trailers. This movie comes out on July 16th. I have no idea what this is going to be like. All I know is it's Nick Cage. I'm on board. I want to get your initial reactions to this trailer. Obviously, Just Canadian is going to be there on day one. Just Canadian is going to go to the premiere.
I'm actually driving to Just Canadian's house, picking him up, and we're going to watch together.
Oh, you guys are going together?
Yeah, we're going together. It's
oh,
really exciting.
Fuck yeah, dude.
Yeah, we're going to have dinner and things like that. Cuddles looks like he wants to go for the ride as well, too. But... Yeah, no, here's the thing. Yeah, it costs a fortune to train. And first of all, I mentioned this to Dude beforehand. And is anybody out there familiar with this? From what I've always been told, pigs like that actually make great domestic, like, in-house pets even. You see people these days sometimes, like, walk around in parks with fucking pigs. Can't believe you've never
that
seen that.
That part, when you told me that, was, I thought you were...
I wasn't doing
it
a bit. I'm not doing
up.
A bit.
It sounded made up.
It sounds like it, but I'm not
it sounded
doing
like
a bit.
An Ark and Wrath bit.
But... Right. No, instantly, well, first of all, we see the master of the cinematic paradigm, Nick Cage, the one true god. Instantly, I'm already go, okay, well, I'm interested. Yep. But the fact that you're saying that this is a stable role, I feel like, first of all, I want to say I feel like that this movie is going to be more of a thinking than what we're seeing. I feel like that's going to be...
Like they're not showing you everything in the trailer. Like there's
sure,
more to it than
I feel. I feel like it's going to be a little existential. That's just kind of my feeling on it.
Is this going to be the platform, a social commentary?
That's kind of my feelings on it. I feel like there's going to be something similar to that. Like it's going to be a platform, no pun intended, for some form of like... you know, metaphor
kind of
for
message,
current, yeah,
or
some
symbolism.
Message. But you know, it definitely has that John Wick vibes. But I, you know, he's saying he's gonna be stable. I feel like it's gonna be one of those things where, like, even if he goes to like a, let's say, the route of violence, he's clearly been beat up. He clearly got into a
he's
fight.
He's got some kind of a past.
Something happens,
dude.
But is he gonna? He's not gonna go crazy. He's not gonna make some face at the camera or anything either. He's just gonna be doing it really subtly and like without blinking or something like that. So. He must have been some crazy chef. Like, why did he leave the
right.
into the wilderness? My thoughts are is that he was this really renowned chef. He was serving like really rich dirt bags probably, and he saw the kind of things that they were doing or just whatever and decided to leave to the wilderness and say, fuck these people, they're trash, mm-hmm. I'm out, they don't have my services or whatever. Because then they're saying in the trailer, like, do you know who he fucking is? Kind of thing.
Right.
Like,
do you know
this
who
is the renowned whatever, blah, blah, blah. So, but clearly, I think the what we're missing here, and I know everybody's doing their bits, and that's fine, but if you've ever had a pet, or it doesn't even need to be a pet, it needs to be something that you really care about, and it gives you some form of purpose in life, that is legitimately a driver for definitely a lot of triggers and emotions
yeah.
and things that you will do that you might not normally do. So I think that's, again, similar to John Wick, it's going to be kind of a you know, what drives him. It clearly does. He goes, you know, back into society. So, yes, I'm very excited.
Buried Alive, spoiler, ends with the dude smoking the pig.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, too. I'm like, he's going to find the fucking thing. It's going to be like at a diner. Somebody's
having
bacon.
Yeah, that's my cameo. Just me and the electric
right,
smoker.
Right.
There's your truffle pig. We're having it for dinner.
Right, right.
No, I'm on board. Like I said, it's Nick Cage, and yes, he has some misses on his resume. He's got a lot of misses, but the guy takes chances. He's been on a winning streak recently. I can't remember the last time he made a movie. Oh, Jiu-Jitsu.
Never heard of it.
We got Jiu-Jitsu in the mix, but we've got a lot of other great movies. Mom and Dad, Mandy, Color Out of Space, Joe. I mean, he's got a lot of good stuff out there, so... I'll be curious to see what this is like. If this is the man has so much range, he can go crazy. He can be subtle. He's just, it's all about his mannerisms. It's all about everything else that he does. The delivery of his lines. He's always convincing. He's got a lot of misses, Boylock, a lot of misses, but for the hits, there's some of the most memorable performances ever. They're some of my favorite performances by Nicolas Cage ever. And just in general by an actor. So, I'm on board. I'll take the chance. If it's shit, it's shit. And I'll tell you it's shit.
Yeah, we'll say it's shit.
But, I mean, this is just...
Mostly.
It's different than what we've seen him in lately, so I'm on board. I'm in.
Well, you know...
July 16th.
And, you know, many misses, but, you know, to be fair, in that sort of thing, too, it's a game of percentages at that point.
Mm-hmm.
This is a guy who's been just pumping out movies many times throughout the year for now a few years.
He's always committed.
You know, exactly. But, you know, you got great actors like Leo who do, like, a movie every 2 years, whatever it is, right?
And then you got Bruce Willis.
You know? And yeah, you know what I'm saying? So, like, you know, he's going to have a higher ratio of shit movies, but
sure.
Some of the stuff he's been doing in his Twilight, and we've talked about it numerous times here, you know, the things that he's getting himself attached to and the performances he's putting on are, like, It's its own thing, baby.
Sure.
That's what it is. It's its own thing, baby.
Well, I agree. Rock, Con Air, Face Off, they make up for the misses. Rock, Blaylock, have you seen, like, Mandy or Color
yeah,
Out of
yeah.
Space?
See, everybody always goes back to
the
90s
yeah,
and stuff
the
like 90s that,
action flicks.
If you haven't paid attention to the last, like,
five, six years. Which
is
not wrong. I mean,
no,
those are fucking
that's fine.
Great movies.
But if you've not kept up on, like, his later years and, you know, after, like, the National Treasures and the things like that that have been, like,
he takes a lot of chances, a lot of risks.
Right, but he also gets into these cult hit classic kind of movies that do things that you just got to, I mean, if you like Willy's Wonderland.
Oh,
I mean,
Willy's Wonderland. Another
shit.
Just a fucking epic movie. City of Angels, hands down. Oh, my God.
That's just because you love the Goo Goo Dolls soundtrack, Blanco. Don't even lie. Don't even lie.
Gone in 60 seconds. I mean, the guy, look, man, the guy has a resume, and it's impressive. He's got an Oscar. He's got a ton of, like, memorable performances in the action genre. But, man, now what he's doing, he's don't knock the Goo Goo Dolls. Uh-oh. Of course, Seven Dungeons is all about the fucking Goo Goo Dolls. But, no, I'm on board. I'll be there July 16th, whether it's in theaters or on digital. A Guilty Pleasure is National Treasure.
You're not alone on that.
No, Nashville Treasure is a big series.
Yeah, that's you're not alone on that, dude.
That was a Disney joint, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, everyone, there's a lot of people that like National Treasure, man. A lot of people. All right, time to move on to our next movie. And, well, let's just watch the trailer.
Grandmother was right. The boogeyman was real.
It's over.
We can't hurt anyone ever again.
Mm-hmm. No one told you.
Told me what?
Somebody in there?
Michael Myers is alive.
Stop! You had a knife in your stomach.
You and Allison should not have to keep running. Evil dies tonight.
I'm not just gonna sit and watch another innocent person die.
If you track Michael's victim, that's a straight line to Michael's childhood home.
What do we do?
We fight.
Let's hunt him down.
Michael Myers is flesh and blood.
No, Tricky, that was LL Cool J.
The more he survived that fire, the more he kills, the more he transcends.
Run! Go home now!
He's the essence of evil.
Okay. Before I go off, possibly go off on a tangent, I just want to get your thoughts really quick about the trailer.
Go ahead.
That's it, huh? You're not a Halloween guy.
I'm not really a Halloween guy. Sure. I actually love Jamie Lee Curtis. Okay, cool. He's stabby more in front of people. That's weird. There's fire. Okay. Your turn.
Okay. All right. I'm going to try to maintain focus here to get through this as quickly as I can without getting sidetracked and going off on a tangent and getting pissed. First, let me preface this by saying I absolutely love 1978's Halloween. Okay. John Carpenter, that's an absolute classic. Not because it was a slasher, because it wasn't. It was a thriller. It was a high tension thriller. It wasn't about Michael slashing everybody and killing hundreds of thousands of people. It was him stalking people. It was more scary not knowing where he was at than actually seeing him. It was more scary not knowing what his motive was. Okay? The Loomis speech at the Myers house to Sheriff Brackett, just explaining everything. Behind his eyes is the blackest eyes, the devil's eyes. They had no rudimentary sense of right or wrong. He had no idea what motivated Michael Myers. And that is what made him scary. Then, once slashes started taking off Friday the 13th, they went to Halloween 2, made that more of a slasher. Rick, his name escapes me. The director clearly didn't understand John Carpenter's vision, even though John Carpenter wrote the movie, he wrote the script. It was a very poor follow-up to Halloween. And then obviously Season of the Witch, which we'll talk about in a minute. Season of the Witch would have been a much better standalone horror movie. Had it just been called Season of the Witch and not Halloween 3, that movie would actually probably have been received a little bit better. I mean, it was still really campy, and there were some parts that I understand why critics probably didn't like it. But because it had Halloween attached to it and it was part of the series, there's a lot of people that hate that movie, and justifiably so. And then 4, 5, and 6 tried to break into the cult origins of Michael Myers and the Samhain and all this bullshit. And the series went off the rails and it became just your typical slasher. And then we come around to Rob Zombie, and he took on the Halloween franchise. And I loved the first half of that Halloween. The first half of that Halloween was really good because it explored the relationship between Dr. Loomis and a young Michael Myers. You kind of found out that, you know, young Michael Myers was tormented and bullied and abused. And I was like, okay, that's cool. I dig that they're exploring this element. Malcolm McDowell was really good as Dr. Loomis. But as soon as Michael Myers got back to Haddonfield, Rob Zombie went back to just slashers and just cheap kills on shit, and it was really stupid. The second one is an absolute abomination. Okay, that the second Halloween by Rob Zombie is terrible. Then we come back to this, the newest one, which is directed by David Gordon Green. I know the first one was written by one of the writers was actually Danny McBride, which is crazy. Danny McBride was one of the writers of the first, the last reboot. And I really liked the first half of that movie. They explored Jamie Lee Curtis's character. They retconned Halloween 2 and everything else. And they actually, there's some Easter eggs that they kind of like throw in the script where they talk about things that were, you know, a part of the sequels, but they kind of brushed it off as like, no, that's not really what happened. And they explored Jamie Lee Curtis and the trauma that the character went through. And I dig that. I thought that part was really, really cool. And then they get to the twist with the doctor, and it was really terrible. It was a horrible twist. And the movie finished all right with a good showdown with Jamie Lee Curtis and Michael Myers at the house, Jamie Lloyd. It was an okay movie. It was the best of the sequels, but that's not saying much because a lot of the sequels were fucking trash. Now we get this trailer. Nothing about this trailer reminded me of the John Carpenter classic. Nothing about this trailer got me excited. I don't know what it is about any sequels to Halloween, but they're just catering to the slasher fans. And that's cool. If slashers want to see Michael Myers go around and kill people and do shit and not be stealthy, that's awesome. Good for you. I don't know why, dude, but nobody can ever come close to touching what John Carpenter did with the original Halloween. They never come close, ever. The thing that makes Michael Myers scary is the fact that you don't know what his motivation is. And here we are talking about in this one, hey, you know, the more he kills, the more he transcends. He's, you know, alluding that he's not human. Here we go with this bullshit again. Now we're going down the rabbit hole like, oh, what's his true origins? Is he a fucking alien? No, dude, go look at the first one. You didn't know what was his motivation. That was the scariest part. You didn't know where he was half the time. You hear him breathing or you see him in the shadows. Now he's killing off a fucking fire brigade?
In front of everybody?
Come on! Oh, David Gordon Green did pretty good his first outing, and this is what we get for a trailer. He kills like 19 people in this trailer. And the thing that sucks is this doesn't look anything like a Halloween movie other than Michael Myers. But then they do cool stuff like this. Anthony Michael Hall. He's playing Tommy Doyle. That was the little boy in the original Halloween. That's cool. The neighbor kid. They get Tommy Doyle back. Kylie Richards is coming back to play Lindsay Wallace. That was the little girl. They're doing all this shit to pay respect, this fan service. But you guys aren't paying attention to the most important part. What makes Michael scary? It's just, dude, this was such a struggle to watch this trailer and get excited. The reboot was okay. But man, I'm so disappointed with this trailer right now. The more I watch it, the more disappointed I am. This is not Halloween. This is not a Halloween movie. And the fact that they're like, oh, executive produced by John Carpenter. John Carpenter has to be sitting there on set, 90 years old, however old he is, just going, what the fuck am I watching? What is this abomination? What are you doing to my character? Now, look, it's a trailer, and I get it. Okay? Don't judge a book by its cover. But man, I don't know, dude. This was a disappointing trailer. I'm glad that Jamie Lee Curtis is back. I love Jamie Lee Curtis. I actually think Judy Greer is a really good actress.
Mm-hmm. From Detroit.
Yep. Andy Matichak is really, really good as the daughter, as the granddaughter. And I mean, you got people like Anthony Michael Hall as Tommy Doyle. That's awesome. I love Anthony Michael Hall. Rusty. That's Rusty Griswold. John Carpenter is 73. Awesome. 73 means he's more aware of how fucking terrible and shitty these movies are getting. I hope it's good. But man, this trailer was not a good trailer. This is not a good trailer for a Halloween movie at all. This was the opposite. This is what I expect from Halloween 2. this feels like the same path that the original series went and where Rob Zombie went. It's like, okay, the first one, decent entry. Next one, shit. And then, and David Gordon Green, I think he signed up for three movies. And then there is. It's Halloween Kills this year, and then Halloween Ends next year. Fuck. Is this where we're headed? Can't wait to see how shitty Halloween Ends is. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to get mad, but I'm such a huge fan of the original Halloween movie, and here we are making the same mistake. Now, hopefully, maybe this trailer is bullshit. Oh, Jay Hill is the winner.
Oh, shit.
Of the G Fuel Energy Formula.
Damn, I guess we were getting close. Didn't realize.
I didn't even realize it. But Jay Hill, you have won! ! Claim.
There you go, buddy.
There you go. Congratulations, Jay Hill, my man. And we'll get this to you within the next 6 months.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Absolutely within the next six months, man.
Thank you again.
You coming to Michigan at all, Burrow? You coming to Michigan at all?
Yeah, when are you coming up this way?
I think he was just up here recently back in May.
He's going to make me food.
He's supposed to make us food. He's supposed to make me food. But no, I was there for a month. He was there. But you were up north. You weren't in Saginaw. You weren't here. But I will get this to you, my friend. I will get this to you. Thank you so much for your support. We appreciate you being here. Congratulations. You are the winner. Who has the code for G Fuel? What, did I have it written wrong? He's talking about code.
No, the code. So this is, again, just as a reminder, everybody, we bought this using it's Boots, her code, Boots.
There you go.
Make sure to enter that in if you want to buy some G Fuel, get 10% discount on. We picked this up on her behalf. She is now partnered with G Fuel. We're very excited for her.
Yep.
We want to make sure we give her support. You guys follow her socials as well, too. The Booty Haver, especially on Twitter, and also on Instagram. Give her some love. She's got great content. She's super fun.
It's pretty amazing.
Pretty amazing. So very excited that we were able to pick this up. Very excited that she's partnered with G Fuel for one. And then, you know, if you guys get down on this stuff, it's good stuff.
Use Jay Hill, I will get this to you soon. I'm glad he won because that took me off the rails. I can go back to the show. This trailer wasn't good. Hopefully the movie is. My expectations are incredibly low right now, though.
Yeah, no, it's fine. I get that energy.
I have an appreciation for what John Carpenter tried to do with the original.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's a reason he's considered the master of horror. He did incredible things with the original Halloween, and nobody has been able to come close other than David Gordon Green's reboot. And this looks like it's going to be just shit. So, I don't know. I'm done. We're going to move on to another trailer that dropped yesterday. And we're fucking hyped about it.
Shit, Forge Hammer, you better be out there.
I hope Forge Hammer's here because I know he's a fan. I'm a fan. You're a fan. I'm sure there's plenty of other people who are fans. Let's check out the trailer for the Maine Saints of Newark.
When I was a kid, guys like me were brought up to follow codes.
Hey, jerk off.
What'd you say?
What?
I love that scene.
Antonio Soprano.
I wonder if I can talk to you alone for a moment, Mrs. Soprano. On the basis of the Sanford-Binet, he's high IQ.
You can't prove it by me. He's got a D plus average.
Well, he doesn't apply himself, but he is smart. The results tell us. He's a leader.
Uncle Dick.
Growing up with the family takes a toll.
Maybe an ambassador to England or France.
It is drastic.
My like to gamble.
I want to do whatever I can to help you.
You may be a businessman.
My gift to you.
I want to go to college. I can't get caught with shit like this.
Look, you take the speakers, right? At the same time, you say to yourself, this is the last time I'm ever going to steal something. It's that simple.
Let me go talk to him.
He only listens to Dickie.
Gotta do something about Dickie Matasani.
Maybe some of the things you do aren't God's favorite.
You lead by example. We'll make the right decision. This kid's got what it takes.
As far as your nephew goes,
I'm listening.
Stay out of his life.
Let's go, baby.
Yes, it was Ray Liotta.
Let's go, baby.
Yes, it was Ray Liotta.
This shit looks fucking hype.
Yeah, dude. I'm super fucking stoked about this.
Dude.
Big time.
The Main Saints of Newark. This is directed by Alan Taylor, who directed multiple episodes of The Sopranos and Game of Thrones. So the guy knows the material. Starring Michael Gandolfini, the great James Gandolfini's son. And you and I saw in that first scene where that guy's like, yo, what's he call him? A douchebag.
Dickhead or something.
And then he turns around and he's like, what'd you call me? I was just like, oh my God, dude.
Dude, sounds, the look,
dude,
of the head tilt.
Uncanny.
The head tilt, the half face.
Uncanny resemblance to Tony Soprano, or to James Gandolfini. Also starring Ray Liotta. We saw him in the trailer. Alessandro Navallo, John Bernthal, and Vera Farmiga. This cast looks dope. This movie looks fucking awesome. I guess he watched his dad a lot from The Sopranos to nail that character. He had to have, man. The Jay Hill, if you get a chance, if you have HBO Max, you got to watch The Sopranos.
You got to watch Sopranos.
The Sopranos. And don't let the talk about the way the series ended deter you from doing so. Look, there's a lot of people that didn't like the way it ended, but this is not like a Dexter or a Game of Thrones finale botch job. But the show is fucking amazing. It's an incredible show, and it is definitely worth a binge watch. And yes, I'm with El Blanco. I did not have an issue with the way The Sopranos ended.
No.
I had no way with it. We talked about it before the show, and you mentioned a couple things that were interesting. There's a lot of theories that go into the ending of that show, and it's awesome. I thought it was a good ending. Josh says, so I'm guessing this trailer has a lot to call back to the show. Then, well, the show, basically what this is it's from Tony Soprano's perspective when he's a kid, but the story itself revolves around Dickie Moltisanti, which is Chris Moltisanti's father. That's Michael Imperioli's character in Sopranos. That's Chris. That's Tony Soprano's like his nephew. It's like his right-hand guy. He's always with him. And so they're going to focus on his dad. But this trailer was fucking...
Yeah, movie
dope.
Danner.
The trailer was dope, dude. I want to get your thoughts.
We watched this a couple times just trying to get the audio set for tonight. Every single fucking time in that phone booth at the beginning.
Oh yeah.
Both me and you go, oh my God. Like that, and that's
the way
it was.
Just the
way
he tilts his head and looks at him. I'm just like, dude.
Everything. The tilt, the way he kind of like half like looks at, like, the half smirk, like,
he's
the way he says
it. He's got that Tony Soprano attitude,
man. Oh, my God.
Man.
It's fucking... And he even does look like a young version of James.
Oh, hell yeah.
You know? And,
uncanny.
And, listen, so I watched Sopranos, the entire series, probably about 3 years ago. And that, I watched it after. And I do that with a lot of series.
Let me address that. Yes. No, it is coming to HBO Max. It'll also be HBO Max. It's day and date. It's in theaters, but it's also on HBO Max day and date. It's part of their whole slate of movies this year that are coming... HBO Max and theaters on day one.
But, you know, yes, this. So, as always, like, I'm late to these series, but that's how I like to do them because I want to binge on my time and go. I don't have patience. It's really hard for me to wait weekly. It's very, very tough on me, but first world problems. But this series was instantly like slow burn for some. I was like,
it really was. Like, but I mean, it's a slow burn, but it's character development. It's
right.
Very important. But when the show would ratchet it up, when it was time to go, like it was intense.
Right.
But that's the beauty of the slow burn is that it's the character development was so strong. The dialogue with Tony and Lorraine Bracco and her character, the shrink, there was just so much.
Yes, there's
so much great dialogue.
And I know this has been analyzed a million times, but it's definitely something like I even told you. I said the series is one of those series where you could sit here and talk for a long time.
Oh, absolutely.
And because it's kind of POV and there's a lot going on, these are this is a series you can literally conversate about and even argue about or have different perceptions or perceptive of. So, but yeah, at the end of the day, I'm super hyped about this. I've been thinking about recently. I'd forgotten this was in development for one. And I was just telling you earlier too. Like last week, I was thinking, man, kind of time for a Sopranos rewatch, because if there's one thing I do know when it comes to HBO, that my favorite shows in HBO, this to me is how I know it's a good series. That intro music or song,
oh, yeah,
is fucking killer. And this is one of the top like four or five of HBO. So that means you got to watch it. So if you haven't seen Sopranos, definitely see Sopranos. I don't know necessarily if you'd need to see the series before this movie.
You probably don't, but I think, you know, if you want to appreciate some of the characters that you're going to come across.
Yeah, I think that would be a better level of appreciation. But yeah, I am super, super hyped for this. So
the only thing I'm kind of bummed about is that it's a movie and not a series.
That I do concur.
That's my only concern about this, is that it's a movie and not a series. I would love to see, obviously, them do something nice this as a series, because obviously these characters are fucking amazing, but this is just a movie. Maybe it will turn into a series. Yeah, that'd be fucking sweet. I'd be hype about it. But, you know, yeah, I'll watch this no matter what, just because I'm a big fan of the series. I love the character. I love the casting. The casting is phenomenal. Mm-hmm. Phenomenal casting. And, I mean, what a way to pay tribute to his father, to play him, the same character as his dad. And I mean to really just nail that uncanny resemblance.
We don't get those opportunities much in Hollywood.
No, dude, you don't. And that's how you fucking do a trailer. That was a fucking sweet trailer. I'm hyped as fuck.
What'd you say to me?
Yeah, what'd you say to me? Man, I mean, it was Tony Soprano through and through. But yeah, this drops on October 1st. It'll be in theaters and HBO Max day and date. Make sure you check it out. If you haven't, you have plenty of time. Binge the series. It's fucking awesome. James Gandolfini. Look, man, he got typecast a lot, but this is the role that I'll always remember him for. He was just incredible. He commanded the screen, and it was awesome. Can we talk about how Ray went from being 40 to 80 overnight?
Spit out my
He's
beer.
Having a hard time shaking off that weight off in the movie Narc. Do you remember that movie Narc?
Yeah,
with him and Jason Patrick. He put on a ton of weight for that, and he had that fucking epic goatee.
Epic ass goatee. Yeah.
Narc is amazing. Well, yeah, Ray Liotta definitely got a little bit bigger at his age, but still, I'm a Ray Liotta fan. I love his movies. I love his. Really? I think he's a talented actor. So I just watched Blow again over the weekend. That's right. He's what's Johnny Depp's name? He's his dad.
He's also Tony Vicetti from Grand Tony Theft Auto.
That's right. He's in Grand Theft Auto.
Vice City, baby.
But yeah, obviously Goodfellas and No Escape.
Right.
If you guys have not seen No Escape with Ray Liotta and Stuart Wilson, it's very difficult to find this movie now. You can't find it digital. You might be able to find a DVD somewhere online or Amazon. But No Escape with it's got Ray Liotta, Lance Henriksen, Ernie Hudson, and Stuart Wilson is the bad guy. Fucking underrated 90s sci-fi flick, dude. No Escape was fucking awesome. I still like when Lecter feeds him his own brain. Yeah, he was in Hannibal.
Hannibal. He's messing with the different lobes. He's like, oh, it's delicious.
He eats his own fucking brain, man. I forgot about that. Yeah, he's in Hannibal. Awesome trailer, though, man. I was really, really happy with that trailer. I'm really excited for that movie. I'll be there day one for that shit for sure. All right. Moving on to the final trailer of the evening. We actually took a look at the teaser when that dropped a couple months back. Now we have the official trailer for Shang-Chi. Let's take a look.
Throughout my life, the Ten Rings gave our family power. If you want them to be yours one day, you have to show me you are strong enough to carry them.
You are a product of all who came before you. The legacy of your family. You are your mother. And whether you like it or not, you are also your father.
I told my men they wouldn't be able to kill you if they tried. Glad I was right.
is just a criminal who murders people. Be careful how you speak to me, boy. I thought I could change my name. Start a new life. But I could never escape his shadow. My son, you can't run from your past.
Is this what you wanted?
You got this.
Oh, shit.
Thank you. Jab, left hook,
right hook. Woo! Boy, that ending, though. Who was that guy? I've seen him before.
Might have been Abomination.
And Tone, now that might have been, that is Abomination, but what is the significance of this Abomination?
Well, the actor Tim Roth, who played him in 2008's Incredible Hulk, reprising that.
Really? And now why is that significant?
Because it, once again, actually more solidifies, even though they won't say it since it wasn't done by technically, you know, Disney, the Incredible Hulk movie is kind of part of the MCU. It's not the full MCU,
right?
But the fact they're going to use that character like they did Thunderbolt Ross, it's a big deal because that kind of says, okay, we're still recognizing that this is like part of that in some way, you know, even if it doesn't get the full name of MCU since it's owned by Universal. But
that's pretty sweet. That's get Tim dope. Roth in. That's yeah, awesome.
Right. Let's do it.
Overall thoughts on the trailer? I mean, I feel like this was, compared to the original trailer that we saw, the teaser was cool. This was hype.
This was really hype. And I keep saying, like, and I said this from Phase 4, and a lot of people are like, oh, gosh, you know, we're losing Robert Downey Jr., we're losing Chris Evans, we're losing these big names, these big characters, or whatever. Listen, they took a chance at Guardians of the Galaxy. Look what happened. And I believe that this next phase, yes, it's a lot of, like, B and maybe some C characters in there, too. But that's more exciting to be able to
It's all about presentation.
Well, you're taking characters that don't have a lot of sight on them or people don't know a lot of. That's new territory. So that's new ground to get excited. Like, listen, I know a lot of people these days like pre-packaged like stories without a lot of thought or intellect in them. I get that. That's not me. I want to either be challenged or to learn some new characters or get some variety, explore some different characters. That's what's exciting about this. We're getting like, you know, this is still tied, like even with that little thing they did after Iron Man 3 with the Mandarin and the goof they did with that. This is the actual Mandarin. There'll probably be a little bit more tie into that. They do say that the cult or that not cult, but the group that were following the Ten Rings in the original Iron Man that captured Tony Stark is a different branch of that or whatever. But this is the actual like group of the Ten Rings here. So and his father is the actual Mandarin at this time. So it's not some Trevor character joke. But my point is that I think this is going to be like, first of all, I love Eastern movies. I love Kung Fu. I love, you know, martial arts like that. So I just think this is going to be awesome action. I think it's going to surprise people. It's going to blow people kind of out of the water on some of this, you know. But, man, I got to tell you that for all that you saw in that trailer, the Wakanda-ish or the Black Panther vibes, like the culture weaved in, I think that's a big important piece why they wanted something like this out there as well.
Absolutely,
too,
absolutely.
Which is great as well, too, for some diversity. But man, it all mattered for me at the end when I saw Abomination. Like the dragon was cool. Don't get me wrong.
The dragon was fucking awesome.
Yeah, and there's a lot to speculate what's going on and how this is going to work into the MCU going further and things like that as well. There's some great talk out there about that. But seeing Abomination in that trailer fighting what looked like maybe Wong, we don't know,
right?
But it kind of looked like Wong out there, and probably Madripoor once again, kind of like
because we saw Madripoor in. Mm-hmm. Falcon and the Winter Soldier.
Soldiers kind of keep weaving that in. That's kind of the guess right now. But again, just Abomination, man. That's what I'm saying.
Because we already talked about Halloween Crash. You didn't miss much. It's embarrassment. But this trailer was dope. I had a lot of fun with it. And like I said, this is going to be a fun, exciting movie. It's going to be wild. So this looks really great. And the fact that, you know, when we saw the trailer, I thought the dragon was gonna be like the most like, oh shit, that's crazy. But then after that, you see Abomination, like, oh shit, okay,
yeah,
let's
yeah.
go.
That's fucking hype. So
that's awesome.
Lisa,
so
Alexa, don't know about y'all, but I'm tired of seeing Robert Downey Jr. and all those Muppets. So it's refreshing to have something new. I think that's the point at the end of the day. Yeah, like MCU was an 11-year build. It was fantastic. We had a great crescendo. We got to move forward. And I think there's going to be a lot of stuff. I think Phase 4 is going to surprise people on how, I mean, listen, if they can make great things with great characters, or even take characters like Guardians of the Galaxy and you know, make them popular, it's so far with the formula outside of Star Wars, like Disney's done a really good job, you know, with the MCU for the most part and doing what they've been doing with these characters. Now weaving in with Disney Plus and everything like that too. Like, I think Phase 4, while people are kind of not sold on it, just because they don't know all the main characters, and even I like don't know a whole lot about Shang-Chi, but that's exciting.
And see, and I actually like what Blanco said down there. Actually, it was Cuddles. For a lot of people, everyone but X-Men and Spider-Man, everyone else was pretty much kind of like unknown. And, you know, before once they announced, you know, Robert Downey Jr. is playing Iron Man, obviously people were like, oh, shit, okay, now I'll pay attention. Mm-hmm. You know, because it was X-Men, Spider-Man, you know, and that was pretty much everything you were going with. And then, you know, we saw the success of Blade, and everyone was like, oh, cool, Blade, you know, Wesley Snipes. And then once they rolled out Iron Man, they were like, okay, Robert Downey's attached to this. And Robert Downey Jr., his career at that time was kind of flailing in the wind. We weren't really sure if Robert Downey Jr. was going to come back from the issues that he had been going through, but then it took off. It took off. And like you mentioned, Guardians of the Galaxy took off, and nobody kind of expected that. So now you have these other characters, some of these smaller characters, Wanda, you know, Shang-Chi, all this stuff. This is starting to get kind of exciting, and it's all about presentation. If it's fun and it's exciting and the characters are fucking cool and compelling, that's how you take. That's how you build them up, man. You got to build them up. You can't just. You got to build them up. You got to build up the hype. Absolutely. And this trailer was a great way to build the hype. So I thought this was an awesome trailer. I'm really excited for this. This comes out on September 3rd. We had a question in there. Where's my damn Howard the Duck, man? I loved Howard the Duck when I was a kid. I loved that movie when I was a kid. Trying to watch it now is fucking painful. It's fucking painful. It's amazing that Tim Robbins' career survived. It's amazing that Leia Thompson's career survived after being in that movie. That movie was fucking trash. And I loved it as a kid. The bedroom scene, right. Not enough for me to love the movie. And then you got Jeffrey Jones. Even though he was awesome as Dark Overlord, you know what happened with Jeffrey Jones. It's kind of hard to like be excited to watch him. It's kind of like watching Kevin Spacey now. You're like, I don't know if I can watch this.
Right.
And I mean, that sucks for like for Jeffrey Jones, because obviously he was, you know, Rooney, Edward Rooney, and Ferris Bueller's Day Off. He was a big guy in the 80s. But overall, Howard the Duck is absolute fucking trash.
Crash Fin Fang Foom, technically, I believe, was in Iron Man 3. That was the he was the guy, the bad guy, and I can't think of his name offhand. Shit, long hair guy, end up being kind of like a human version of him. So I was hoping there'd be a version of him in this, but I don't think we'll see that. And I think they'll stay away from that for some of that.
Crash says, I thought the Halloween trailer showed too much. If they showed too much, then they showed
too much.
I don't want to even see it. If they showed too much of that movie, then I'm gonna fucking just avoid that like the plague. I'm gonna go in with the lowest expectations and probably still hate it.
Cuddles, and I really do too. He's still working on that. Jamie Foxx is still tied to that.
Which one?
A new Spawn reboot movie.
Oh, really?
I was talking about going to the comic book store earlier. My favorite comic book hero, anti-hero of all time, like Spawn is still my favorite of all of them, and I started picking up his new series that just dropped, so I'll be picking that up monthly. So I definitely want some more Spawn. Yes, end of the day, great trailer.
Great trailer. Really excited for it. Really excited. How you doing?
Good. Go ahead.
You doing okay? Man, I am so proud of you.
Thank you.
I don't pee anymore. All right, moving on to the next topic. We got two episodes of Bad Batch to discuss. Two episodes, because we were off last week. And by the way, thanks again to everybody that tuned in and played Among Us last week. We had a hell of a time. Among Us is just, it's a great community
We
game.
Should have had the clip up here. I didn't think about it till right now to see Dude be a scumbag as per usual. but as always, we learned during community game night that this community is full of scumbags. So,
and we love each and every one of our scumbags.
Yep.
You're the reason we do this show. Tone, Bad Batch episode 8 and 9. Mm-hmm. We got some big reveal in episode 9, but I want to get your overall thoughts on the last couple episodes of Bad Batch.
8 was awesome. 8 kind of like was kind of like a slow out of like, hey, we just got the chips removed. We're, you know, hopefully these heroes can continue forward and without flipping out on each other, which was great. You know, Crosshair shows up. all shit breaks loose.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly what you'd expect. They have to use more, which is, once again, showcasing Bad Batch, using some ingenuity and some, like, thinking to get them out of, like, this crazy situation. Their big battle, they pretty much nearly get away, or you think about to get away, and then all of a sudden,
yep.
All of a sudden, you hear this kind of, like, westerny theme click in, and you hear this, like, twang, and all of a sudden you see the pan up, and here stands none other than fucking bounty hunter Cad Bane, who we've not seen in a few years. Because there hasn't been a whole lot of Clone Wars stuff, and Season 7 didn't have him in it, of course. Mm-hmm. He hadn't been around for quite a while, and this is clearly a fan favorite when it comes to the Clone Wars series, and a character that became a character during the Clone Wars, the cartoon, never been a live-action character. It's just another one of those few that are just, like, super popular due to that, and who knows how he could be alive in the galaxy, of course, which would be great. But such a great homage to, like, the old Western characters. Originally, people thought he was more... the actual character that Clint Eastwood plays in The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly in that series.
Oh, shit, The Stranger with No Name?
Yep, The Stranger with No Name series. But they think it's actually, he's based off a character in that, the older guy with the little black mustache.
Lee Van Cleef?
Right, with the, he's always got like the,
something. Yeah.
They say a lot of the mannerisms and things and how he even stands and everything is very, very reminiscent of him. So no one's really got the word, you know, what he's kind of like taken from, but that's kind of what everybody's assumption is. But anyways, great character. He basically, at that point, he captures Omega, and we're off at that point. Like, where, now what the fuck,
yeah,
right?
Now what's going on?
Now what the fuck? So Crosshair doesn't leave the battle unscathed. He definitely takes one for the team somehow, which I thought was a good choice to kind of see him. Like, he's been, like, the entire time, like, this scary storm in the horizon, and he tries to come at him, and he gets to eat some shit for a change. So that was pretty awesome. But then the episode after last week's episode was fucking, oh man, there's been some really good episodes this season. This is probably top three for me so far, and this is probably near the top one or two just generally. This episode is great because you really got some action with Cad Bane.
Yep.
You know, they go to this, some of us think it seems to be like an original cloning site for the Kaminoans, because the Kaminoans don't look like they belong on Kamino. Like, they're not aquatic by any means.
Right.
You know, they look very like lizard birdy. Like, it would almost make sense to me they were somewhere from maybe like air ish or something like that.
Right.
You know, but anyways, they're this older facility that clearly this cloning has been going on.
Yep.
That's where Cad Bane goes to meet his bounty, meet up. There's some crazy shit going on with like the Lamassu and Tanwi, and like this tug and pull with some of the power at Kamino, you know, trying to save Omega, or do we want Omega pieced out or whatever's
right,
going
yeah,
on
they
there.
They just want Omega for what we find out why we find
right,
out why
right.
they
we
want
find
Omega.
Out why what's so big about it and why they either want to pieced out or keep. But there's a sweet battle scene because Fennec shows up.
Yep.
She's back in play too. She fights Cad Bane. It's a really dope scene. Like, again, the entire episode is really cool. Like, he comes out of the smoke sometimes. Like, there's a lot of really neat scenes in this.
A
very,
lot of
very,
cool, like, Western type
yeah,
of shit.
Yeah, yeah, along with the sound and everything, too. Like, the Western music when he's around was great. But the big reveal, if you haven't seen it and you're scared, I'll give you a second. But most of you probably don't, you know, watch it as enthusiastic as I do. But the big reveal is that Omega, why she's so important. Omega's the end of the Greek alphabet. Well, there's an alpha, right?
There's always an alpha.
Who's the alpha? Well, Alpha and Omega reveal that Omega is an unaltered DNA clone of Jango Fett, which means, of course, the other original would be Boba Fett. So I thought that was a really cool reveal.
Dude, that, I mean, you know, I don't know a lot about the Clone Wars and the story of these characters and stuff, but man, when I heard that, I was like, oh shit, this is important. I was like, this is fucking dope.
Right, that was pretty fucking wild. That was a whole setup. So to be able to kind of call about once again and say him by name in the series was also big too. That was the first time in the series we probably heard that name, I believe, if I remember correctly.
I don't think we've heard Boba before.
I don't think so either. But it just shows again a couple of things. One, Omega is clearly way more important, like we kind of figured.
Yep.
You know, and we've always kind of known that. I still think she's force sensitive. There's more to that going on.
Oh,
I think,
she's,
and that's
she
play,
definitely is. She definitely is force sensitive.
Yep. That's going to play into down the road, I think, and it will tie into Mandalorian real soon here, I think, as well, too. But the big thing, again, is that from, you know, a standpoint from fans, when Bad Batch started and they added this new character and it was a young character and you're like, it's the same shit like you had to go through with Ahsoka. You know, but we should have believed that's Dave Filoni. Be patient. This character, for me, and I think I'm not alone on this, has grown on everybody because they, you know, they make it like, oh, here's an annoying kid character. Then right. what they do is they hook you in with the story because yep. it's written so well. So you end up invested in it and caring, and then you get to watch the character grow as well, too. So it's less about annoying and more about you just like, listen, dude, like, just kind of be patient and go with it, you know? Omega.
Omega.
Yes. Omega. It's not Wrecker, it's Ricker. Ricker.
Ricker.
But yeah, so we're still about halfway point. So we still got a lot to go, which is crazy to think.
But dude, this show is so good.
The show really is good. Like in Clone Wars, like had a lot of issues with jumping around and certain story elements that you had to tell, like that were boring from a political standpoint.
Let me read this. What Cuddles just said. Yeah. So you're cool with making a character if it's Star Wars, but Mortal Kombat, be damned. Whoa.
Well.
Whoa.
They're definitely Ruh-roh. Well. So the easy way to just to say that and then to ban you is that there's a difference between developing a character story well and making it sense and taking the time to build that character instead of just wedging something into a 2.5 hour movie and just wanting you to, you know, swallow that pill. Makes no sense and doesn't fit. You take that character out again of that movie, the Cole. Take Cole out, does not affect the movie. You take Omega out of this series, it affects the story because she's a central integral part of the story. That's pretty simple.
Cole had now they're just trolling you. Now they're just getting you. I heard Cole was the best part of the movie.
If you want to see my if you want to see my thoughts on the Mortal Kombat movie that HBO still allows them to have sometimes on their network, check out the Banter and Babble YouTube channel. Is
1,100 views.
1,100 views now.
Fuck
so
yeah,
that,
thanks, y'all.
Yeah, we appreciate that. Still
Cole was the Citizen Kane of characters.
Anyways.
The guy avoids that. Well done, Tone. You're growing up.
So, good episode, and I can't wait for more. And this series is, again, the Clone Wars was a good watch, but there was a lot of episodes that felt like filler that were sometimes boring, admittedly so. What's nice about this is that it's not. It's a central bunch of characters. You're not having to worry about you get in the galaxy as a whole as the Empire is transitioning into the Empire as well too. But it's a little bit more. I think after all this time, Dave has a little bit more not only control in some way, but he knows he's got a pace.
Yep,
that's what we're seeing.
No, I'm digging the story. I'm digging the characters. I love the relationship, the rapport between everybody. I love the fact that they're bringing in these characters that, you know, fans of the series can appreciate. I think that's really, really cool. Oh, wow. Thanks, guys.
Somebody just dropped a...
Oh, thanks, y'all. Appreciate that. Appreciate that support. As always, you guys are amazing. Thank you guys and girls so much. We appreciate that support.
I think somebody dropped it. Is that Prime? You do that Prime? That you Prime out there?
Oh, there... Don't shout me out, you racist. Thank you, Prime. We appreciate that, brother. We appreciate that, man.
Hey,
no, but yeah, I'm digging this show. The show is it's a lot of fun. Like I said, the action is awesome. It's well thought out. It's got great pacing. It's got great reveals. The locations they visit are really, really cool. You know, and to see you get excited about some of these locations that I'm not familiar with, but to understand the relevance of them and the importance of them and how like fans who truly watch every single thing and read all the books, they can appreciate that. I think that's fucking awesome that they do that stuff.
Yeah, it's really exciting.
So, yeah, I'm digging the show. 7 more episodes to go. Hopefully, Omega and Ricker can get through this. I'm a big fan of Wrecker, man. I love Wrecker.
If he's not your favorite character in this series, you're kind of...
Something's wrong. Even though I do kind of like Hunter, man. I like Hunter. He's a level-headed...
Oh, yeah, that's...
That's Tekken.
That's
Tekken
fine. Yeah, they're all fine, but, like, you still have to love Wrecker.
It's Wrecker, man. It's Wrecker.
He's a big teddy bear.
He's a big old teddy bear. All right. The final topic of the evening and the most exciting topic probably by far. Let's talk about Loki. We're going to talk about 2 episodes. I mean, I don't know why we're talking about 2 episodes. I thought 3 was kind of meh. I think you have a different opinion of that. But we got 3 and 4. Episode 4 dropped today. If you have not seen episode 4 of Loki, fuck out of here. Fuck out of here and then watch it tomorrow on YouTube or later this weekend or whenever you get a chance to watch it. But leave. We don't want to ruin this for you. But Tone, coming back to you again, dude. I know you want to chime in on episode 3. I think there was some good elements in episode 3. Mm-hmm. building up the relationship between Loki and now we know her name is Sylvie, the other Loki variant. It was a good build up episode for character development between those two and their relationship, but everything else I felt was kind of like by the numbers and just kind of like meh compared to everything we saw in episodes 1 and 2. I don't know if it handled the action sequences as well as I would have liked, but episode 4 was a different beast altogether. But I want to get your thoughts on episode 3 and 4.
I really liked 3 because 3 was a locale, a new locale. You know, we'd been in the TVA for a while, which is really cool. But, like, this was another chance for the MCU to, you know, explore not Earth as well, too,
yep,
but a new
absolutely.
Place as well.
Sure.
And there's some really interesting deep-seated roots that everybody kind of speculates to. I can't think of the planet where the Nova Corps is from. Lament.
Leminsky
ties to what's the planet from Nova Prime? Fuck, I can't even think of the name of the planet offhand.
Crash, help him.
Yeah, what's the planet from the Nova Corps is from? Maybe El Blanco will get on that too. They think that's got ties to that one, or those folks are from, like, survivors from that planet as well too. But they go to this planet and it's about to be, you know, an apocalyptic issue. The moon's basically going to drop onto the planet that they're at. Mm-hmm. And they got to somehow escape. Overall, yes. Was it a super exciting episode? No. And the action, I think,
Xander.
Thank you. Yes, Xander. Everybody was like, look, they think everybody's originally from Xander because this takes place, I think, after that tragedy. So, it was a really good growth episode.
It was necessary for Sylvie and Loki.
Was really, really necessary because this is the first chance you had to learn about Sylvie and kind of get an idea of this character. And she's an important character because eventually down the road in the next phases, she's going to be integral with like New Avengers and things like that, because they're definitely building New Avengers
mm-hmm.
with the Disney Plus series exclusively for sure. I enjoyed it because you got to kind of learn a little bit more about her. You kind of knew maybe what was driving her some. But more importantly, you got to see, you know, Loki, Tom Hiddleston's Loki, kind of evolve. I think a lot of his...
Open up to somebody a little bit.
Yeah, you didn't see that a whole lot.
No, he's always been very kind of closed off, alone, much like we'll talk about episode 4. Yep. But yeah, he's always been kind of like this loner. He doesn't rely on anybody. He doesn't count on anybody. Doesn't need anybody. And now he meets this episode, of course, it's himself in a way. And yeah, there's a connection that we haven't seen from Loki's character.
All right, now I see it, Blanco. Can we talk about how this whole series finally answers the life question? Would you fuck a gender-bent version of yourself? we'll touch on that as well, too, Blanco. But thank you for eloquently putting it as you always do. Appreciate that. Not a lot of crazy excitement in the episode. It's pretty straightforward. They're trying to get off this planet. They lost their little TA fucking phone, whatever it is. They're on a train. They talk. It was great character development for both of them. Again, the discussion of love. Yes, you're seeing Tom Hiddleston's Loki again, still continue to evolve. And because they can focus on that outside the actual movie MCUs, and then at the end they're kind of like, oh shit, we're up against a brick wall, sweet. And in that moment,
that cliffhanger.
Yeah, in that moment, that's when something kind of happens interesting that kind of tips off the TVA, which, again, would you gender bend version of yourself? Well, I suppose maybe. Why not, right? It's very, very classic Loki. So then this week's episode, which, again, last week, a lot of people seemed to be really excited about it. I know you and some folks didn't seem to be.
I appreciate it for what it was. It was character build up, and I get that. But like, it's when the action picked up. It just didn't do anything for me. It was supposed to be an exciting sequence, and I thought it was kind of meh. But, I mean, in terms of character development, it was really, really important.
Yeah, it was very
especially after what happened in this episode.
Yeah, so this episode, we get to this episode, and it's fucking, like, bonkers. Like, you know, they get saved. They're trapped. We get Jamie Alexander back as Lady Sif for the first time. I'm pretty sure you guys can check me on this. I think the last time she was with anything MCU was in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., like season 1 or 2 or something like that, maybe even 3. But I don't think she's been in anything
else. She wasn't in Ragnarok, right?
She wasn't in Ragnarok. I don't know since... There it is.
There it goes. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., yep.
Sweet. That was out me. Awesome, yeah. So it's cool to see her again kind of reprise that role, which was just kind of out of nowhere.
She gets to beat the shit out of him in a time loop, too. Pretty, I thought that was hilarious.
It was very Sif and very Loki, like that combination. I thought that was fantastic as well, too. Again, you keep getting like, man, Owen Wilson, like what a random character for you to like just all of a sudden like really, really get tied to.
Yep.
Man,
this was a really powerful episode.
This was
for
a
him.
Very powerful episode for, again, most characters.
Most of the characters,
like,
yeah.
Loki starts realizing himself, and he's trying to be Loki, and they're trying, like, the conversation between him and Mobius, again, was, like, something you kind of almost have to navigate in some way. That's kind of how those characters would work. But, honestly, their fucking chemistry is so good.
Yeah.
It's so good. You know, you get invested to where they're coming from and how they're growing and how they're talking. Like, I was literally hanging on every word of their conversation.
Yep.
Because I literally didn't know if at one point he was going to hit a button and Loki was going to be pieced out or
right.
Or something. You knew something was
going
to happen.
You could tell he was growing. He had a lot. Mobius has a lot going on in this episode. And you started to see that he's feeling the pressure of the timekeepers, and he needs to figure out what the fuck is going on. Mm-hmm. And he's tired of Loki's bullshit. He calls him an asshole. I mean, it's they're past the friendship point. Mobius is tired of the bullshit.
Yeah, and you know, it gets hot and heavy after there. People start realizing when he starts saying TVA is lying to you.
Yep.
For some reason, like that triggered something in him. Like, you know, why would he say that of all the you know, because I was thinking about that. I'm like, why would that trigger him? Well, Loki, instead of saying anything about himself to save himself,
mm-hmm.
I think this is where it was why he started looking at it differently. Is because instead of that, he decided to like try to prod him or wake him up.
And he said that thing before he went into that portal. He said, "You're lying to yourself.
That's
the only
what
thing you lied to is you lied to yourself about
yourself.
What's going on." And it's almost like because you go back to the moment where Mobius is reading that magazine. Or he talks about his magazine about jet skiing and stuff. Like, there's something about all that interests Mobius. And I think once he hears that, you know, you're lying to yourself and the TVA isn't real. I think at that moment, he's piecing things together in his mind. He's like, man, something is amiss here. Something is off.
I already started to think something's going on because of the agent dying all of a sudden. Yes.
Yeah, when C-20.
Yeah, he was already kind of, you know, he was trying to figure out what was going on with the C-20 and all that stuff.
I think Prime's onto something. I think when he was on vacation, because we saw at the beginning of the episode that when they went back for Sylvie, she's a fucking kid. She's a kid. She's a small child, and they literally just show up and just take her. And when she's in the elevator with Ravonna or whatever her name is, she's like, "Why did you take me? I'm so important." And she's like, "I don't even know."
Yeah, I think she was doing that to be.
Well, she smirked. She had that smirk, but I mean, at the same time, it's just like they just go back and just take people.
There's a reason we're going to get to why the TVA was built. It's because there's somebody sinister pulling the strings, which came full circle in this episode finally as well, too, which I was really, really kind of considering and then end up coming true, which I thought was great. So, anyways, yeah. So, you know, Mobius kind of starts figuring out and realizing that Loki's saying something real to him for once. And that evolves. Basically, you know, we're getting everything figured out. I'm gonna try to keep some of the spoilers out.
We can talk about it. I mean, he has a sit down with Ravonna.
Yep.
And at this point, he's already suspecting something is off because he's not getting the information he wants regarding C-20. You know, Loki's spewing all this stuff, and so they're having a conversation in her office. He's like, "Hey, what are you gonna do with that sword? What are you gonna put that on your trophy mantle?" And as she walks over, he switches out that whatever that fucking device is that called teleponder or something like that.
Tampon.
And as you know, once he makes the swap, he leaves the room, and then he goes to the library and he watches a video, and it's of C-20. And she's explaining, because earlier in the previous episode, when they find her, she's like, "It's real, it's real." And they're like, "What the fuck is she talking about?" And we see at the beginning of this episode that whenever Sylvia touches somebody or uses her enchantress powers, she can't create memories for people. She has to use the memories they have. And even though they can't remember what they were, once they see them, it starts to trigger it. She realizes C-20 realizes where she's from. And so as they're interviewing C-20 afterwards, she starts to say this stuff like, "This isn't real. I know I'm not from here. I'm a variant." In the video, it shows it cut it off, and Ravonna is like looking at the camera like, "Oh, shit." And so now we know C-20 didn't die from whatever happened. She was pieced out.
Because she got better, and she was actually explaining the situation.
She's explaining what's going on.
Right. So that's pretty big there. So, but flash forward through the rest of the episode, we finally get a kind of like a breakout. And, well, not breakout yet, I should say. We finally get a visit, visit to the timekeeper.
And holy shit. Because not only is Mobius aware of what's going on, so is B-15. Because as you remember in the episode when they're at that mall or whatever, she gets touched by the Enchantress powers, and she saw her past. And so as she's talking to Mobius earlier on in the episode, she knows something's up. And so she knows what's going on. So as we saw a character get pieced out, we can talk about it, man. Talk about what happened.
We lost a character tonight. So if you've not seen this and don't want spoilers, mute, walk away right now, because it's about to.
Jay Hill said, "I couldn't understand what two of the timekeepers were saying bad English. That's why I turned on those subtitles."
There you go.
Because honestly, man, I was watching. I was like, "What the fuck are they saying?" And like, it sounds they tried to give it like a synthesizer, or like a mechanical voice. And I was like, I can't understand what's going on. So I had to go back and put on the subtitles so I could read it.
Because, yeah, along with that, what Sylvie's basically doing, she's trying, early on, everybody thinks that it was, we were hoodwinked in that, I think some of us called that early on. At least, no, I did it in my home. I said, probably about the second episode, Sylvie's not the bad guy. I don't think she's the bad guy, and she's not.
Mm-hmm.
And that kind of definitely, you learn that over the last episode into this one as well, too. But we lose a pretty integral character. Out of nowhere.
I think you can go. Okay. Honestly, if you haven't seen it, leave, because we're going to talk about some heavy stuff.
Yes. So, Mobius gets pieced out.
In a shocking turn of events.
And it just kind of like, I was like this.
Yeah, when it happened, I was like, what the fuck?
I was like, wow.
Well, J-Hill, look, he gets pieced out in this episode. I don't think he's gone. Because he needs closure. He was done like nothing.
He
came through the portal and Ravonna and some of the other time cops. Some of the time cops were there, and like he doesn't get that moment. He doesn't get his closure. He doesn't get that redemption arc. You know, he's trying to redeem himself because he realized the TVA is full
of
shit.
All we want to see was him on a jet ski.
I better see my man on a jet ski. I want to see Mobius on a jet ski. That's all I'm asking for.
So that was quite shocking. And then Ravonna takes Sylvie and Loki to see the timekeepers. And there's a little fight breaks out. B-15 shows up, right? B-15?
Yep, B-15
shows
up.
They have a little battle as well, too. And you're sitting there, and the timekeepers are talking to you, all three of them. And a sword goes flying at one of them. And just
Sylvie.
As I knew, it's a whole Wizard of Oz setup. These motherfuckers ain't even
the
real.
The timekeepers
are
fucking
just,
robots.
They're fucking animatronics. So somebody pulling the strings. So now we got to pull the curtain back.
And
to
see,
out
that
is.
For me right there blew my mind. Because the whole episode, the whole series so far, you're like the timekeepers and the time variant authority is legit. And it's like, you know, this is a real thing. And now we find out it's all bullshit. It's all bullshit, which is mind-blowing shit, dude. It's mind-blowing shit. What's Crash say? I think Mobius is coming back. I think the pruning just sends people to a destroyed timeline. The timekeeper's robots blew my fucking mind. I think Kang is possibly behind everything, and Ravonna is helping him.
I totally think. Listen, and like right before the head popped off, I kept thinking this, and I thought this like maybe... I don't know if it was the second episode. I'm like, what if the timekeepers are? Because I really feel like Kang is involved here. So I kept thinking, like, if he's not one of the timekeepers, then he is pulling some strings.
There's something going on.
So, like, right before that head popped off, I'm like, instead of saying, oh, that's about to die, I'm like, they're not real. And sure enough, boom, pops off. And,
the other ones all just kind of like, they all shut down.
Motherfuck. So I do think Kang is still involved. How much Ravonna knows about that, I don't know necessarily, and maybe more. Clearly, the whole point of the timeline being in, like, somebody being in control of the timeline is clearly for some form of, I guess, control, or maybe to have the ability to control or move around. We don't even know what would be driving that. Like, now that this is all taken care of, that means that, again, of course, to get into Doctor Strange as well, too, and maybe even Spider-Man some. Now, if the multiverse is now existing, because apparently it wasn't beforehand, mm-hmm. you know, minus, I guess, I don't know how we consider the quantum realm in that. That's something I want to know. I want, like, some MCU explanation for quantum realm and, you know, whatever. Because Kang's hometown, we saw in, was it Doctor Strange or Ant-Man and Wasp, inside the quantum realm. You see the city inside... You know, at one point as a little kind of flyby. So, and that's kind of where he's supposed to be residing. But like, how does that tie into, you know, all this, like, at all? And you know what? If we're wrong that Kang isn't pulling all the strings of that, then I don't know who the fuck else.
They're doing a hell of a job disguising stuff.
Right. So at the end of the day, like.
And we got to talk about the end credit scene. We got to talk about everything that happened.
So the end credit scene.
Well, first of all, after B-15 comes in and tries to aid, like, Loki and Sylvie.
Excited.
You know, they get, it's like Ravonna's knocked out, and Sylvie has just decapitated one of the timekeepers. Her and Loki are speaking, and out of nowhere, Loki gets fucking pruned.
Loki's about to tell Sylvie that he's kind of in love with her.
Yeah, Loki's about to, like, reveal his feelings to himself, which is the most narcissistic thing one can do, is fall in love with himself.
Very Loki, very
Loki. As before he does that, Ravonna gets up and prunes Loki, and he's peaced out. At first, that's what we think. Like, he's gone. And we're like, what the fuck, dude? Like, what is going on? And so after that, you know, it's Ravonna and Sylvie, and you think Ravonna's gonna kill Sylvie, but she doesn't. She goes, "You're gonna tell me everything you know." Boom, credits. So Sylvie has Ravonna where she wants her. Boom, credits. But in the first time in this series, we have an end credit scene. And in the end credit scene, it shows Loki on the ground. He wakes up, and he looks up, and he says, "What do you say? Where am I?" And he looks up, and there are four Loki variants. There is one that's wielding the hammer.
Looks like some form of Mjolnir or something.
Yep, it looks like Thor's hammer. Yeah, he says, "Is this hell?" Yeah, he says, "Is this hell?" There's an
with old, one L.
Yeah, with one L. There's an old Loki. There's another child Loki, a boy Loki, and an alligator Loki. There's four Lokis. One of them is a goddamn alligator Loki. Incredible finale.
Yeah.
And now, you can tell in the background where they're at. Wherever he's been sent, where all these Loki variants have been sent. And earlier in the show, Mobius says, "I'm tired of dealing with Lokis." So how many Lokis have they sent back?
How many variants?
Back?
Yeah, because that's
he
the
says
whole thing.
I'm tired of dealing with
I'm
Lokis.
Dealing with Lokis, like
plural.
Yeah. So clearly, like there's more that we're just getting breadcrumbs for some of this stuff in this part of the series, which is pretty interesting. You know, but definitely like the TVA is dealt with. I mean, I guess it should have made sense. So you see a drawer full of Infinity Stones just laying there,
right?
Some of the same ones.
Yeah, it's really bizarre. And, you know, and we noticed that all the Lokis are in some version of New York, because in the background, it's a nuked out New York, or it's an apocalyptic New York, and you can see Avengers Tower. Stark Tower in the background is one of the buildings that's completely wiped out. So what they're doing there, why they've been sent there, we don't know. All speculation right now. But this was the mind-blowing episode of the season.
Yeah.
Because now all bets are off. We don't know what the fuck is going on, and that's wild.
Yeah, so here we go. So we got a lot of good stuff going on there. So people are talking about, and this is what I keep saying, like when it comes to the multiverse and Doctor Strange and even the Spider-Man, how those are going to somehow tie in. Yes, could the Andrew and the Toby versions be different versions or variants of the Tom
Hiddleston? Tom Holland.
Tom Holland's version of Spider-Man. That's one way to explain it. As well too, and that maybe that's how the multiverse works. Is there's variants of everything. It doesn't mean you're the same thing in a different timeline at all. You know, so that's
I never thought about that.
Right. So that's what I'm saying. I still feel like all this stuff that's going to leave Doctor Strange, Spider-Man is going to take a part of this as well too.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely do. So that's great stuff out there as well too. Different Lokis out there that we're seeing. I know Crash is really excited about it. He said Richard E. Grant's outfit. Hope he's the 616. Is that 616?
616 Loki.
The alligator Loki could lead to Throg. I'm not overly familiar with some of this stuff, but apparently there's different versions. Like there's a unicorn Loki. Definitely am very aware of Frog Thor, things like that as well, too. But the question I would have, though, too, is how this could even play in Love and Thunder, because, you know, we've seen in the comics before, too, like there are many different Thors in the multiverse, like tons of them. You know, so. Is this series going to play a part into numerous things that we keep speculating? Like, clearly, you know, somehow with Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness, somehow with the Spider-Man, and going forward in the MCU, how it's going to take place, could it affect Thor, Love, and Thunder? Is this how we get the X-Men? Things like that. But what's interesting to note, to kind of side note to go with this as well, too, speaking of Doctor Strange, is that Elizabeth Olsen, I think they wrapped up with Doctor Strange. They've done a lot so far.
Mm-hmm.
She said this is like Sam Raimi horror levels of shit. She was like, holy shit kind of thing. So that's got me really hyped. And that's what I was hoping for. Multiverse of Madness wasn't just going to be like a comic booky spacey. I want some fucking Sam Raimi horror. And apparently that's a thing. So pretty excited.
Yeah, it's it was a phenomenal episode. It was the most exciting episode, the most like mind blowing episode.
Right, Prime.
And now we
right.
And I think somebody Prime just mentioned that Tom Hiddleston said going forward now the show is going to really pick up, which makes sense because mm-hmm. I mean, what we've known in the first couple episodes is now kaput. Now we have no idea what's going on. The show could go in any direction here,
yeah,
because it's everything is bullshit. The TVA is bullshit. But god damn it, yeah. Jay Hill mentions love when Mobius mentioned vampires. Who's a vampire?
Blade.
Awesome little nod there. Awesome little nod. Jane Foster is another version of Thor when the actual Thor was unworthy. Perhaps yep. Jane is a variant.
That's possible. Maybe I'll explain it. Jane is a variant. Who knows how they're going to play that? I don't know. See, I don't know. I think Jane's still going to pick up the mantle and not be a variant of Thor because I think it's the same timeline. We could be wrong in that. That's just what I think.
Mm-hmm.
But absolutely.
Dope episode. It was a really, really good yeah. episode. We only have, was it two episodes left?
More episodes
we
left,
have
dudes.
Two episodes left.
And then next week, coming to Disney Plus and Thursday opening in theaters.
Black Widow.
Got my ticket for Thursday night, 6 p.m. Woo! In Birch Run. See Black Widow. First movie I've seen since the pandemic had started.
And he kind of, that's the, you know, if I wasn't going to be out of town, I wanted to see it in the big theater too, you know, on the big screen. And, you know, you talked about a couple of moments we saw in the trailer. It looked dope. Oh, you know what? Remember the kid pointing to the glass window of the devil in that church?
Yes. Yep. And well, the thing you want to take about that is like it had horns. So you're thinking Loki or you thought Mephisto. Maybe Mephisto. But the first thing I said is that head is purplish. So I said Kang.
Does have a purple tint to it.
Kang.
Does have a purple tint. Kang could be at hand here. So... no, that was an awesome episode. Really, really excited to see where the show is going to go. Two episodes left. We got Black Widow next week. Exciting times for the MCU. Mm-hmm. Be really excited to see where they go with this series. It's been phenomenal so far. But Tone, that is going to do it for tonight's show.
Yes, sir.
We are done. We have talked about everything we want to talk about. But first of all, we want to give a big shout out to everybody that tuned in tonight. Big shout out to Jay Hill for winning the G Fuel Tetris Blast. Big shout out to Booty Haver for being an awesome supporter of the show and a good friend. We were glad to purchase this with your code. And make sure, if you guys and girls are looking to buy some G Fuel, go over to G Fuel and use Boots' code. BOOTZ. Get a 10% discount to our for an order of G Fuel, courtesy of our good friend and partner G Fuel.
Yep, congratulations again.
It's awesome. Congratulations again to her. But I don't know, Tom, what else you got, man? Is that it? Anything else?
Have a great 4th of July if you're in the U.S.
Be
and
safe.
Be safe. Enjoy. Have a hot dog, a Kogel's if you're in the Midwest. Maybe some ice cream, fireworks, firecrackers, whatever it is you might
or
do.
Or just go to Freezy's house.
Or go home
where
and
I'm gonna be.
Check your mailboxes. There should be invitations for Freezy's on Sunday.
It's going to be good eats. We'll have pictures in the Discord and the food porn channel. I'll have a lot of photos. A lot of photos. So, yes, everyone have a great 4th of July weekend. Stay safe. Be careful. Get drunk. Have fun. Celebrate. Be, you know, do what you got to do. It's 4th of July. It's the middle of summer. It's time to have fun. Let's get wild. We'll be back next Wednesday, 9 p.m. Eastern. More banter and babble. I don't know what the fuck. Oh, Godzilla. Talk about Godzilla.
Godzilla is right now. Godzilla Singular Point. It's a awesome anime. I'm about 4 episodes in. Right now on Netflix, about 13 episodes. We will talk about that next week. The plan is to have all those done and watched.
Yes.
All those done and watched.
All of them.
By next week. Very exciting. I'm really enjoying it. It's some interesting takes here, and I really can't wait to talk about that. But, yeah, that's probably the only thing we right now got on the docket. But at the very least, you know where we'll be. So don't forget to also, if you're out there on YouTube, if you're in Spotify, please like, sub, follow, share. Definitely share with us. Give us comments, email us, let us know what you think of the product. Got any suggestions, feel free to reach out as well, too. We do appreciate all your support. That word of mouth is super important.
Pretty good way to follow it, man. Awesome. Fanboy Tone, I'm the Dude 79. Everyone have a great weekend, great 4th of July. We'll see you back here next Wednesday night, 9 p.m. Eastern. Be good.